But I can't hear you guys now. No, he's not.
Can you hear me now?
I can. It's... Can you ask him to repeat?
Priyanka, can you hear me now?
So, Pawan, we can hear Shailendra, but his voice is not clear.
Voice clear. Voice.
Ma'am, hello. Am I audible, ma'am? Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, Shailendra, this is better.
Yes, this will be better. Can you see the video of Hyderabad?
I can see the video of the stage right now.
Yeah, 1 second, sir. 1 second.
Please, rotate.
1 second. We'll be showing you the participants.
Yes, I can see that.
Okay, otherwise audio is clear, ma'am? Loud and clear, right?
Audio is clear and the video is clear as well right now.
Yeah, I think your video is on mute, it seems to be.
No, I'm saying that I'm able to see your video clearly and I'm able to hear you as well.
Priyanka, can you on your video once? We can, we will check the display on the panel.
1 second.
Yes. Hey, Priyanka, we can watch it. You can switch it off. Priyanka, you can switch off the video. It's visible. Priyanka, we'll leave the meeting as it is.
Morning, Dr. Swaminathan. Morning, afternoon, evening, I don't know what time zone you're in, so. How are you, ma'am?
Good morning.
Okay, fantastic.
I'm fine.
And is it afternoon, morning, what is it?
How are you?
Very, very good, ma'am, very good. You know, we have Mahima Datla, we have Dr. Krishna Ella, and we have Anand Kumar, all of us, and of course, you've been here in Genome Valley in 2017, February, about 3 years ago, 3.5 years ago.
Yes.
I'm told you're in Geneva. Ma'am?
I remember that visit very well to the Genome Valley.
Oh, thank you.
And visiting several of the...
We'll get started whenever you're ready. So, can we get started?
Yes, I'm ready.
And you're going to be with us for what, 45 minutes, 1 hour? Depending on that, we'll structure the flow.
Yes.
Yeah?
45 minutes, I can
still. All right, thank you. Thank you so much. So good afternoon to Dr. Soumya Swaminathan, who's the Chief Scientist of World Health Organization. She is somebody who's very familiar with the life sciences ecosystem of India, of course, and also the life sciences ecosystem of Telangana and Hyderabad, and more particularly Genome Valley, which is right here. She was, in fact, she obviously, like I pointed out just now, she had visited Genome Valley in 2017, about three plus years ago. And we also have had a couple of interactions with her when she was heading ICMR. And just a pleasure and delight to have you, ma'am, with us. Thank you very much for joining us. And thank you very much for your time. We have with us Mahima Datla of Biological E. We have Anand Kumar of Indian Immunologicals. And we also have Dr. Krishna Ella of Bharat Biotech. As we all know, this is an unprecedented time. These are uncharted waters for all of us, in fact, without an exception. So this is an exciting time also from the perspective of, just believing that every adversity has an inherent opportunity that lies within. And today, Hyderabad and our life sciences ecosystem here is truly fortified its position, has really shown its strength to the world, not only from our pharmaceutical sector, but also from our biotechnology and vaccine manufacturing facilities in Hyderabad. I'm proud to share with you that Hyderabad continues to remain, one of the leaders in vaccine manufacturing. We, in fact, today manufacture more than one-third vaccines that are used globally. And we also have, in fact, like I pointed out, been home to pharma companies which have been producing the drugs such as Remdesivir, Flavipiravir, etc., which have all been in use in the last few months. Delighted that Hyderabad's ecosystem, more particularly the three companies which are right here with us, are leading the vaccine race. There are more than 150 vaccines that are currently under development at various stages across the world. But within India, we have six companies that are in the race. And out of those six, I'm proud to share with you, four of them actually are headquartered in Hyderabad, and three of them are sitting right here with us. So I'm here more to learn from them. I'm here more to understand from them, like every other layman out there in India and elsewhere, on what is happening in today's world and what is happening in the vaccine manufacturing and also other developments with respect to COVID and this pandemic. We'll get started, with Dr. Swaminathan. Did we lose her? Dr. Swaminathan, Soumyaji. We'll get started with you, ma'am. Ma'am, you'll have to unmute yourself. We'll get started with you.
Yes.
Yeah. Ma'am, just a quick, initial thoughts. A lot of data, a lot of research, a lot of articles these days, with WhatsApp and, social media being all pervasive. Everybody seems to know everything, but let me get it from the Chief Scientist of World Health Organization. How long do you think we have to learn to live with this? Because I think that realization has dawned upon all of us that we have to coexist with the virus for a bit. But how long do you think we have to live with this? How long do you think we have to coexist? How do you see the future panning out over the next few months at least?
Yes. No. Thank you very much, Minister. First of all, congratulations on organizing this program today. I think it's very timely. The discussion on vaccines really needs to happen at different levels, both globally and nationally. I'd like to tell you a little bit about what we are doing and how we are thinking about it, and also answer your question about how long will this last and what else should we be doing. Maybe I can start with that. We know now that this novel coronavirus has established itself in the world. It has gone into practically every country, and wherever it has found a situation where it's able to spread easily from person to person, it has established community transmission, and it just goes through the population because we do not have much of pre-existing immunity to this. Now, I will add a caveat there because we are still learning about the immunity to this virus. It is possible that previous exposure to some other coronaviruses might offer some protection. That is one of the questions which are still open and can only be answered if we study cohorts of people right through and establish cohorts and see who are the people who get more severe infection versus less severe infection. Why do children appear to be relatively less susceptible to disease? They do get the infection, but they don't get sick most of the time. And why is it that with increasing age and with some of the comorbidities, we see increasing severity and increasing mortality? And how long is the immunity going to last after natural infection? We know now that most people who have natural infection develop neutralizing antibodies, and they also seem to develop T cell immunity. So both the cellular and the humoral immune system is activated. But what we don't know is when do these antibodies start reducing, and for how long is there protective immunity? And this has implications for vaccines. If long-lasting immunity cannot be achieved after a natural infection, with the vaccine, again, we'll have to see. Because the vaccine is targeting, right now, all the vaccines are targeting the spike protein. The first-generation vaccines are all targeting the spike protein because it's the most immunogenic protein of the virus. The only risk is if the virus develops a mutation which causes it to escape the immunity which is conferred by the antibodies against the spike protein, then we are in a difficulty. So the second generation of vaccines actually targeting other antigens as well. So we need also backup plan. And the second thing which we can only do when we introduce the vaccine into phase 3 trials and follow people is to see how long is the immunity going to last, the protective immunity, whether it's a sterilizing immunity or it's only a disease modifying immunity. Both types could happen with different vaccine candidates. So the message I would like to give right at the beginning is that for the foreseeable future, at least for the next 12 months, we need to put in place the public health and social measures that have been shown to work. And this is at the level of the government, the community, and the individual. Most countries who have controlled the virus successfully in the first phase have been because of good governance, good strategic planning based on scientific knowledge and based on evidence, and because of involvement of community and individual trust, good communication between the government and the people, clear communication, and being prepared to manage what is likely to happen in the future. We know that lockdowns are a temporary measure, which reduces the spread because you prevent people from getting close together. And the idea of the lockdown was to buy time for the government to put in place the systems needed to tackle the virus. And I strongly believe, and the WHO has been repeatedly emphasizing the fact, that testing is extremely important. Unless we test adequately, we don't know where the virus is. And Dr. Tedros once used the phrase, fighting a fire blindfolded. If you do not test, it's like fighting a fire blindfolded. We have to test and test and test. But testing alone is not going to solve the problem. It's the first step. That, of course, has to be followed by isolation of positive people, contact tracing, quarantining, taking care of those who are positive, following them to make sure that they don't get into the interstitial pneumonia and complications by monitoring their oxygen saturation. So it's a comprehensive package which needs to be put in place, particularly in those places where there is a high density of population, so the cities, for example. In the rural areas, it would be good to have some kind of a surveillance going on so that you know what is going on. This surveillance is usually done in the form of influenza-like illness surveillance or severe acute respiratory illness surveillance, what we call as ILI and SARI surveillance. If everybody who comes in with symptoms suggestive of influenza or of pneumonia is also tested for COVID-19, apart from other infections, like you can do a combined influenza COVID test, then you have a sort of a constant surveillance going on in the rural areas to know which districts, which villages are seeing infections going up. But in the cities, the only way out is to expand testing. India as a whole, the testing rates are much lower compared to some of the countries who have done well, like Germany, Taiwan, South Korea, Japan. Even the United States is testing a huge number of people every day. So we need to have some benchmarks. In every public health department needs to have benchmarks on what is the rate of testing per lakh or per million. What is the test positivity rate? The moment your test positivity rate is above 5%, you know that we are not testing adequately. And then also looking constantly and monitoring the availability of beds, the availability of quarantine facilities, the availability of ICU, oxygen availability in the district hospitals, and so on. So there is a set of about 8 to 10 indicators that the government needs to keep a close watch on. And you can ramp up and ramp down based on what you're seeing on the ground. And the other thing is about the communication to people and what people have to do. It's very nice to see everyone wearing a mask. And I must say, I've been impressed in Chennai also, where the mask compliance seems to be very, very high. I'm not sure what it is in the rural areas or in the districts. We need to keep on, because I think wearing a mask properly and using a mask properly is also something people need to learn. If the mask is hanging down below the nose or mouth, it's not going to be effective. But modeling has shown that if everyone wears a mask, you can really cut down on transmission. So it's really a very affordable, cost-effective, and effective measure for people. The other thing is, of course, maintaining distance as far as possible. In some situations, it's less possible because of slum areas and things like that. And also, we know where the clusters can happen. These happen in closed environments where people spend time together. So that is why you have to limit the number of people, but you have industries, factories, other kinds of places, even offices, where people just have to go because you have to restart your economy. That is where then you need to, again, to have a surveillance mechanism, temperature monitoring, making sure everybody's masked, making sure that people maintain the distance, that they have the respiratory etiquette, etc. So it's a very painstaking process. All of these steps, if they are to be implemented properly, but they do bear fruit and they do give results if done. Now, over to vaccines, because that's what everybody is looking at as an exit strategy from the pandemic. Let's hope that several of the vaccine candidates in testing, today there are 27, I think, or 28 vaccines that are in clinical trials, and another 150-odd which are in preclinical testing. At least 5 are now entering phase 3 trials. So we will know in the next few months about the safety and efficacy of these vaccines. And I emphasize safety as very important, because to get public trust, when you're going to vaccinate huge numbers of healthy individuals, the safety bar of the vaccine has to be set quite high in order for it to be acceptable and usable in the population. So things like the disease enhancement, which is something which has happened previously with other vaccines, and other rare side effects that you notice only when tens of thousands of people have been vaccinated, those have to be really followed up. So one of the things we need to prepare for is a pharmacovigilance strategy and mechanisms, not just during the clinical trial, but after licensure and after it starts getting used widely. We need to keep an eye for the next couple of years on the safety profile of this vaccine. Efficacy, of course, is important, and the WHO has already put out guidance on what we consider as acceptable efficacy. So it would be good to have a vaccine with at least 70% efficacy, minimum of 50%, but with a lower bound of efficacy not falling below 30%. Because modeling has shown that anything below 50% efficacious vaccine is not going to have much of a public health impact. So that's a kind of a benchmark that we hope for. Now, through the ACT Accelerator that WHO launched on April 24th with many, many partners, what we are hoping to do is to speed up the R&D for vaccines, therapeutics, and diagnostics, but also ensure equitable access. So it's not just a question of faster development, but also of fair and equitable access to populations around the world. We do not want to be in a situation which happened as during the H1N1 pandemic 2009-10, when a few rich countries bought most of the supplies and stocks of vaccines and only started donating it to the lower income countries when they realized that infection probably wasn't as serious or severe as it was supposed to be, and they had excess stocks. Now, if that happens again this time, then I think all of us would have failed. What we hope to do is to, as vaccines become available, to distribute them across the world to protect those who are the most vulnerable, the frontline workers, the health workers, the others who are at highest risk of getting infection, then the vulnerable group within the community, and then go to the rest of the population as the stocks become more and more available. So the COVAX initiative, which is WHO, CEPI, and Gavi, aims to have 2 billion doses of the vaccine by end of 2021. A realistic timeline to start getting the first millions of doses would be the first half of 2021. But then will come the distribution, the delivery, and then for countries to be able to start vaccinating their populations. This is something that ministries are already looking at. They are drawing up their policies. They're looking at supply chain and other logistics that will be needed. One of the things we don't know is what the storage conditions will be. There are a couple of vaccines which need to be stored at minus 70 or minus 50. Others, hopefully, at 4 to 8 degrees. So we have to be prepared for those. And we have to get agreement between countries. In the next few weeks, actually, we need to get agreement that they will follow the fair allocation mechanism that's being developed by WHO. Side by side, the COVAX facility is being set up by Gavi. This is a risk pooling mechanism where self-financing countries can put in some funds so that they can procure vaccines for their populations. And they are pooling the risk because the COVAX facility will buy vaccines which are going to be proven to be safe and efficacious. And at the same time, the ODA funds will pay for the vaccines which will go to the Gavi-eligible countries. the number of Gavi eligible countries has been increased now to 92. India, of course, is a Gavi eligible country, and so should be getting the vaccine doses from the COVAX facility. But India being a hub of manufacturing could also consider how and they are going to really interact with the rest of the world and with the COVAX facility in terms of sharing of the vaccines that are going to be produced in India, and a lot of them are going to be produced in Hyderabad.
Yes, ma'am. In fact,
we are fortunate that Mahima is on the panel. She's on the board for the COVAX facility. There's a coordinating mechanism, and she represents the Developing Country Vaccine Manufacturers Association. So we have a strong voice from India on that board as we shape it up and as it moves. As I said, the next few weeks are going to be quite critical. Over to you, Minister.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. In fact, like you pointed out, India continues to remain a hub for vaccine manufacturing. And within India, Telangana and Hyderabad have been, on the forefront. And today, like I pointed out, more than one third of global vaccines are produced from Genome Valley in Hyderabad. So we're very proud, and all the very, very pertinent points you made. Thank you very much. But one quick thing before I turn, quick question before I turn to the panel here, of the industry leaders. Yesterday, I had read a statement from the World Health Organization chief saying that while a vaccine, the hope for a vaccine is very real and it might happen, there is also an equal chance that there could never be a vaccine. Can you help us understand this? Because, vaccine in current situation seems to be a ray of hope, but there must be a reason, there must be a logic. I'm sure the industry here will never, possibly agree with whatever was said, but nevertheless, help us understand why or what would prompt someone to say, like in the case of HIV, how there could never be a vaccine. In case of COVID as well, it was pointed out yesterday that there also is a chance, however fat or slim it is, that there could never be a vaccine. Is that a fair reasoning, fair thought process? What are your thoughts?
So I think the experts who are sitting with you know very well that vaccine development is a risky business and that success is not assured. We have many diseases for which we don't have vaccines, in spite of a lot of R&D having been done over decades, like HIV, TB, malaria, etc. We have so far not had a vaccine for a coronavirus. So this is a new endeavor. So we are optimistic because of the efforts going into it and because of the number of different platforms that are being tested. But we haven't understood the virus completely. And so there is always a possibility that we don't get it right or that it takes longer. We may not get it right the first time. It may take longer. And that is why I think the DG is warning people, do not believe that the problem is going to be solved in 6 months or 12 months. We don't know that for sure. Unless we see results from the phase 3 efficacy trials, and unless we follow people up to see how long they are protected for, we really can't say that this problem is going to come to an end in 2021 or 2022. So I think he's preparing people to think longer term and to think about public health, vaccine being one part of the battle. Vaccine is not the silver bullet, I think is what he said. Drugs are also important, and new drugs are being also tested because that can bring down the severity, that can prevent death. So that's a very important one. And new diagnostics also, like the antigen detection tests, etc., saliva tests will help.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Now let me turn to the industry leaders here. We'll start with Dr. Krishna Iyer of Bharat Biotech. As we talk about the race for vaccine development, as we talk about the efficacy of the vaccine, the longevity of its impact, et cetera, help me understand, because normally from a layman's perspective, I am a layman, I would love to understand this. Normally I hear that it would take anywhere from a few years to sometimes even a decade to create and produce a vaccine, because there is a lot of science involved, there is a lot of trials involved, there is a lot of practices involved to make sure that the drug is actually efficient, the vaccine is actually efficient and very, very long in terms of its impact as well. I hope you're not compromising on the science in this pursuit, in this race, you know, in this sort of a rat race, so to speak, of one against another. I hope the science of the vaccine development is not being compromised, is not being adversely impacted. Can you help us understand how you're able to overcome these, typical timelines, et cetera, and how we are able to now already, because I've been to your facility, Bharat Biotech, in fact, Covaxin and other vaccines that you're currently developing are already nearly in the phase three stage. So help us understand how you're taking care of the science behind and ensuring the efficacy of the vaccine is also taken into account before we talk about a full-fledged launch. Help us understand, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Honorable Minister. And we are really proud of Soumya heading the WHO. I think first Indian and first woman candidate heading there. We are proud of you. And I think, you know, the vaccine field takes 14 to 15 years a vaccine to develop. So we are trying to develop in less than 18 months or 12 months in this vaccine. It's complicated. But at the same time, with the vaccine experience, we are also much more cautious. It's not that we are trying to make it a vaccine just to move it fast to the market, no. I think we are putting a lot of intensive research in all 360 degrees, and that is where the partnership is helping us with US, WHO, everybody helping us to look at the criticu, some of the scientific aspect of it, so that we don't short-circuit the science. That is not there. So we are much more rigorous today. But problem, as Soumya said, the virus is a new one. So it's like a relationship. You need to build a relationship with the virus to understand how this virus behaves. Besides, the people's genetic makeup also is playing a role. As she said, we don't know whether all of us had a respiratory pathogen infection. That might be the reason why you have death rate less in this country compared to the Italy or Spain, where the high death rate. So we might have got a lot of other infections before respiratory pathogens. So I think, you know, we are not short-circuiting in any way the science. And I can tell you, our science is all criticued by the global community, not by India alone. It's a global community. So rest assured that any of the Hyderabad company or Indian company will short-circuit on science on this matter. That I can assure them.
Thank you, Krishna. In fact, that's very comforting to hear because, you know, while we are all actively wanting a very, very impactful vaccine coming out ASAP, possibly day after tomorrow or yesterday, in fact, the fact is we cannot afford to short-circuit, like you put, you know, the whole science behind vaccine development. Now, let me turn over to Mahima. As Dr. Swaminathan pointed out, you're in a very pivotal role right now, representing the developed countries in Gavi, and also your company, Biologically, has been in vaccine development for more than nearly five decades now, and a very, very reputed organization which has known the science. Why don't you walk us through, because again, from a very layman perspective, there are multiple approaches to a vaccine. If there are 150 vaccines that are currently under preparation, et cetera, what are the different approaches the world is taking? What is the difference between the vaccine that you're currently engaged in vis-a-vis Indian Immunologicals or, Covaxin of Bharat or, say, Serum Institute, et cetera. Also talk us through, possibly, how has vaccine development evolved in the last five decades? Because you've been in this business, for the last several decades. So talk us through how scientific developments have helped and possibly how that can be put to good use so that this expeditious delivery that people are anticipating for COVID can be fructified. No. Thanks, Mahima. Cheers. Yeah.
I don't know if you can hear me. Okay. So first of all, I think at the heart of it, vaccine development, to put it in really simplistic terms, is really giving your body a bacteria or a virus that's highly purified. So it's basically stimulating what would naturally be the way a disease would be contracted, but in a very controlled fashion, such that it's giving your body the ability and the time to raise antibodies and fight the infection naturally. And the reason it needs to be controlled is because it needs to be safe. You don't want a high viral load and so on. So at the crux of it, all vaccines aim to do what nature does itself. You know, all the people recovering from COVID, you know, they're getting exposed to the virus and they're raising antibodies and they're getting protected. So this is a way of simulating that. So all vaccines aim to do that. If I had to classify vaccines into the categories that based on the technology platform, currently I would classify them into four. And I'm sorry if there's scientists in the audience, there might be 10, but in my, the way I understand it in my head is into four buckets. So the first bucket is viral vaccines that are inactivated. These can be whole virions or the virus itself that's inactivated either chemically or through heat or through other mechanisms. And I believe Bharat Biotech's Covaxin follows that approach, as do several others. The second bucket, I would say, is protein vaccines. So these are the spike proteins, which is the spike on the corona, giving it its name. They're the RBD, the receptor binding domain-based proteins, which play a role in inhibiting the virus attaching itself to the ACE2 receptors in our body. So there's a whole host of vaccines that are targeting spike proteins or the RBD. The third bucket, I would say, also targets spike proteins or RBD. So effectively, it's a protein approach, but it's also driven by new vectors, either modified vaccine Ankaria or the ADVAC vectors, and so on. And the fourth bucket, I would say, is the other and really novel technologies, which are your DNA vaccines and RNA vaccines, which is basically like a messenger. It's like coding. It's aimed to deliver a code to your genes and to your RNA to start producing antibodies against the virus. And frankly, it's extremely interesting platform technology, extremely exciting. And I think, you know, DNA and RNA vaccines have been in development for close to 15 years now. But this is really an opportune moment to test that technology. But unlike human beings, not all vaccines are created equal, and each of these come with their own sets of challenges in order to develop. Like Dr. Swaminathan pointed out, some of the new DNA and RNA vaccines need to be kept in minus 70 degrees. Now, these are programmatically extremely challenging. But I do want to talk a little bit about, you know, what we're doing to, have an expeditious vaccine. And in many ways, I agree with Dr. Ella that while there's no trade-offs in science, we are collectively making some trade-offs. Because in reality, you would expect a vaccine to be over 90% efficacious. In development, not just now, historically, has to be viewed in the context of risk. Now, when you had widespread polio, we agreed to take the risk that when you take OPV vaccine, 1 in X percentage get polio because of the vaccine. But that's because the risk of polio was so high. I think COVID is similar. The fact that WHO put out TPP requirements for 50 to 80% efficacy tells you the trade-off that we're willing to make, but never at the cost of safety. Because the last thing you want to do is make a situation even worse. Now, coming to our own candidates, we've been working on an RBD protein candidate, and the expression system we're using is yeast, it's Pichia. It's tried and tested. We've made hundreds of million doses of hepatitis B on that platform. And I think much like ourselves, many companies are choosing platforms that they are familiar with, that they have infrastructure for. Because the key to speed is, you know, 150 candidates are not going to be able to make the vaccine in hundreds of millions of doses. And I think that's very key, to marry the technology with the infrastructure and the track record and capability. Now, our choice of RBD was dictated by the infrastructure match that would best allow us to make vaccine as quickly as possible. And so far, we're going to start phase one studies in September. But from the manufacturability perspective, we have enough data that assures us that we'll be in a position to produce 80 to 100 million doses a month of this vaccine from the get-go. I think that's crucial, because in the early years, you're going to have a demand-supply gap and allocations. Everybody is going to fight over it. So it's really important to be able to scale quickly. And when we talk about challenges, you know, we could discuss that. But in my mind, the reason it'll be expeditious is because we are making certain trade-offs in context of risk, but not in relation to safety. We may be making trade-offs in terms of the expectation on timing of protection, because we may say, hey, it's okay if it protects us for 1 year, we'll take it yearly as opposed to a lifetime, but really not at the cost of safety. And the second most important factor is having large-scale infrastructure that you can deploy these technologies into. I hope that
answers. No, absolutely. In fact, before we go to scale, before we talk about how, like Dr. Swaminathan pointed out, you know, some countries tend to hoard, then, you know, at the cost of developing nations, et cetera. Before we go into that, I think one important question that, is currently sort of has been overlooked in the past, but has come to the fore now, is how competition, such as you, all three of you, or in fact, other vaccine manufacturers in the country, including Serum and others, in a country like India, you know, where government doesn't spend too much on R&D. Government per se does not spend a lot of money on research and development. Of course, we encourage private sector to invest in R&D. We encourage private sector, of course, to take the risk. And of course, the reward also will be that much higher. The fact is, this is the first time you three are sharing a podium or a platform, on a vaccine development, or especially in light of COVID. Let me ask you, Anand, Indian Immunologicals again has a long track record. How do we ensure as a government, be it the Telangana government or be it government of India, how do we ensure that while you actively compete with each other, while you actively race up against each other in development of a vaccine, in pursuit of vaccine, isn't there scope for you to collaborate, work with each other, and also talk to each other, engage with each other, so that when humanity is faced with such a huge crisis, should we not be coming together more often as industry, as government, as competition, to collaborate and to come out with more coherent and synergistic strategies? Your thoughts on this? Then we can go into other things.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for organizing a platform where at least three manufacturers who are supposed to be one of the largest in India to come together. As you rightly said, that COVID-19 has offered us a tremendous challenge, especially for all the vaccine manufacturers to come out with a candidate vaccine at a very, very rapid speed. We are, in fact, some of our companies are in talking terms with each other to see if we can combine together to use our facilities. Here, actually, we don't call this as a rat race or something, because here, when humanity is at risk, we are always talking to each other to see that if we can agree on using our combined strength to bring about a vaccine at the fastest pace. In our case, we at Indian Immunologicals, there are various, as Dr. Soumya said, that there are various platforms being pursued. We have chosen a live attenuated codon deoptimized platform. The live attenuated codon deoptimized platform gives tremendous advantage for a country like ours, especially this vaccine needs to be administered right from children to senior citizens. So if the vaccine is going to be priced very high, then it's going to be totally unaffordable for any government. Like I heard one of our competitor vaccine companies saying that a vaccine will be priced at 1,000 rupees a dose. 1,000 rupees a dose for a country of our size. And if you want to achieve, let's say, even 70%, because 70% is a number which is given to as a number for herd immunity. So if you calculate our population of our size at 1,000 rupees, it's going to be several lakh crores of rupees which will be spent on vaccination, totally not feasible. So we have taken an approach, which is a very difficult approach. Because in our live attenuated vaccine technology, it will stimulate both humoral immunity and cell-mediated immune response. And probably one or two doses is sufficient for, we expect that one or two doses is sufficient for the entire lifespan, and the cost would be not as high as well. So under normal circumstances, live attenuated vaccines would take several years to develop. I mean, if you see, there are very successful live attenuated vaccines like measles vaccine, which is rubella vaccine, which is being used now. But we have modern technology called codon deoptimization. With that, with the help of our collaborators in Australia and in the US, we are now, we have almost constructed 20 live attenuated codon deoptimized viruses. We will start the mice studies in September, and then we'll do the non-human primate studies in October. And we are planning to start the phase one trials as early as January 2021. So thing is, like, our approach takes a little longer because technologically it's much more challenging to do. But then when it comes as a vaccine, then we will be the most cost effective, and it'll be a vaccine which, where you administer once or twice, and then you don't have to administer for the rest of the life. So that's the approach that we're taking. And in the meantime, we do have spare capacity. If any of our friends want to utilize some of our fill-finish capacity, they are free to approach us, and we are always happy to share our capacities.
Did you say free to approach, or did you say free to use as well? Thank you, Anand, for that generous offer.
Could I just make a quick comment on the collaboration?
Please, please.
I mean, I was in discussions with Adar from the Serum Institute, and we have an association called the Vaccine Manufacturing Association, in which Indian manufacturers are part of that. And in that context, we've been in discussion over several policy issues, and this certainly came up. There's a principal understanding between us that we will deploy capacities for each other. And what's important to understand, it's not just in the context of COVID, but while we're trying to develop COVID vaccines, we have routine immunization commitments and supply commitments on Rota, on, you know, DPT, Penta. But it's not easy to deploy capacity with each other because of the way the regulatory system is set up. So if Father wanted to say that, you know, B, you fill my pentavalent because, you know, I have COVID obligations, for us to do that, we have to potentially go through clinical trials, but it requires a lot of regulatory work and potentially 6 to 8 months before we even are able to do that. So if we can shift the needle there, it allows more flexibility for us to be open. But I think in principle, we all want to deploy infrastructure in a way that best serves humanity at a critical time like this.
I think you put it really, really pointedly. Krishna, would you like to also comment on this idea of collaboration?
I just want to say that I'm glad you organized this meeting. We may be competing, all three of us, but we're all of us competing with infectious disease. Please keep in mind that we may compete in the marketplace, but we are competing against infectious disease. That is common goal for all of us. You know, I mean, yes, Indian manufacturers need the time now to collaborate more. It's easy to collaborate with the US and other people, but with India, it's a little difficult because we have cultural problems. We don't trust our own brothers, that's unfortunately. So the culture has to change. But definitely that is required. But I want to say one more important point in front of the Honorable Minister. India is manufacturing 100 doses. Serum Institute is only making 30. 70% of the other vaccine comes three manufacturers. Keep that in mind. That means 70% of India comes from three manufacturers. That means Hyderabad is nothing less than Serum Institute. Please keep in mind. As a single company may be different, but all three manufacturers, we are more than double than the Serum Institute as a combined strength of Hyderabad. And I want to tell you that partnership is now, the disease is getting complex. I think we need a partnership. We don't even, we are buying from tetanus from BE now. We said we have to stop importing things rather than we collaborate among ourselves. And I think it will start right now. I think the minister has organized this meeting. It brings some comfort level to all of us also, in a way. But I can tell you one more thing. Telangana will lead innovation in India. Please keep this line tagged. Okay? Telangana will lead the innovation of India. There's nothing less. Because it's not that because ministry is here, I'm telling you this. I'm seeing the ecosystem that we are building in. You see this sort of ecosystem of manufacturing, R&D, very high intense. Bangalore gets unnecessarily a popularity of the media. But actually, we have better better ecosystem than any other state of the country. But I think we need to see, and actually, we've done typhoid conjugate, first vaccine in the world. So that comes from Hyderabad. So a lot of vaccines. Now even B is developing new vaccine. They are developing new vaccine. Everything is going to come from here. So there's nothing less than that. And I think we are nowhere less than any other companies in the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Krishna. In fact, since this morning, I've been hearing a number of things on the innovation front and how important innovation is in your line of work. We have T-Hub in our state. We have T-Works. You know, we have a bunch of other initiatives that start with T. But I've also realized this morning after talking out to all of you that T-cells are equally important. You know, I think in this process, I think we have one more sort of an addition to this T portfolio. But before I go into other questions or other points, I think a question to all three of you. I think each of you should respond to this. See, India now and Indians now are looking forward to you guys with a lot of anticipation. We want the vaccine to be cheap and affordable. We want it to come yesterday, if not, you know, say a month from now, you know, that quickly we want it. We also want accessibility, and like Dr. Swaminathan pointed out, we don't want hoarding happening. We don't want only the privileged and the rich in India to be getting the first shots and, you know, them to be safer than the others. So we cannot have that divide as well. But that is the ask, that is the demand. Now the question to you guys is, what can governments do? Because I just heard Mahima say, sometimes when I want to really change gears and move fast, the regulatory framework comes in the way. Be it in the state, be it the DCGI, be it Delhi. What do we need? What do we need to do as governments to enable you? Because, like I said, you know, we are a developing country, we are a third world country, we can't invest lots and lots of money in research and development from the exchequers or the consolidated money or the exchequers money. But how do we facilitate, how do we encourage you, how do we take away the hurdles, how do we ensure these roadblocks in your regulatory approval processes are removed? The reason why I ask is because I want to appeal to Government of India, from the industry here, from the government here, taking into account all of your viewpoints and taking into account all of your ideas and suggestions. I want to write to them, I want to request them, I want to reach out to them and be your advocate for the industry. In terms of ensuring that we compete with the world on an even keel, if the world is actually moving at a brisk pace, it is primarily because they don't have as many legal hurdles, as many regulatory hurdles as we have in India. So please do vent, please do talk, please do tell us what we need to change from within, in state government here and also in Delhi. What are the things that you would like to see differently? Starting with maybe Krishna, and then we go to Mahima, and then to Anand.
I think this is a very important point. The vaccine field, unfortunately, controlled 90% by the federal government. That is number one. What we need as a Telangana, if you want to become a global player, we need CDSO, which is Drug Controller Office, to have decentralized the power to Hyderabad. We need a South India headquarters of CDSO in the South India so that it can be Hyderabad. And that will strengthen, because we don't have, for a small clearance also, we're rushing to Delhi. It doesn't make sense for us. And the country is a big country. And 60% of the pharma is coming from here. So that, naturally, we need to have CDSO headquarters decentralize some of the power, 90% of the power, to be decentralized and located in Hyderabad. That will change the game for us, for Telangana. Number two, RCGM, DVT. Again, that has to be decentralized. Put a one small institute here, right in Genome Valley. They can be located here with the two offices. They clear everything except the one BSL-3 area, highly contained organism can go there. Remaining all can be done. Because this is the only country, even for small R&D, sir, we need a permission from DBD. I don't know, they are the facilitator of the country's industry, but they're also in the regulatory chair. That is hurting us, actually, very bad. For every small R&D material to import, we need a permission of RCGM. That is going to kill a lot of startup companies in this country. It's hurting us, actually, very bad. And I think RCGM, at least if they can't close down, at least they should be decentralized and put them here. Third important is, every batch that we send to CRI Kasoli, if they can set up in Hyderabad one more testing where state government can build that infrastructure and give it to them, they can have a testing facility here. If they do that, and I think we'll rule the country.
Thank you, Krishna. In fact, on the last point, the testing center has been approved for Hyderabad. It will be up and running hopefully soon. But we'll hear from Mahima as well what she thinks needs to be done by governments in terms of removing these legal hurdles and regulatory hurdles?
So first, sir, I would break it down into the more immediate things that can be done and some of the more institutional challenges, which will take time to accomplish. But once we accomplish those, they will pave the way for more innovation, not just in the context of COVID. So first, in the context of COVID, I would really like to highlight funding. So most manufacturers sitting at this table don't have access. We're doing this at risk. We're doing this, you know, with commercial sources of capital. It's very challenging to do efficacy studies, global efficacy and safety studies, and invest in infrastructure when there's no pull mechanism that's visible. Now, the COVAX facility is one way where they're kind of trying to give you demand certainty, but that hasn't been forthcoming from our own government, which is a bit disappointing because we need to understand what the allocation strategy of the country will look like. Given all vaccines will not be available from day one, what is the volume you need for first responders? What is the volume you need in the second tranche? What is the overall immunization strategy? Is it 60% of the people? Is it 100% of the people? So these kinds of things, and I often use these terms, pull and push mechanisms. There are no pull mechanisms. In the absence of the pull mechanism, it makes the lack of push mechanisms even more extreme. Our funding is extremely fragmented through BIRAC. Many countries, including China and the US, have fully funded at-risk several programs, making sure that they have access to vaccines first, that they have access to a diverse portfolio of vaccines, and setting up, supporting companies to set up huge infrastructure. Now, this has long-term implications because India is the number one vaccine player in the world. In not many industries can we claim to have that advantage, and I worry that by empowering everyone else in this fashion and not empowering India, we are losing in the long term a certain competitive advantage to other countries. This is easily done. The World Bank has $2 billion in funding that they're making available specifically to vaccine manufacturers to expand their infrastructure. But India needs to agree on terms to access those funds and make them available to a handful of manufacturers who have the track record to making this happen. So I've gone out on a limb here, but I think funding is a key thing. The second are the regulatory challenges. And it's not in the day-to-day clearances, because I have to say that between DBT and the DCGI, they have been proactive in reaching out and saying, if you don't get clearance in 24 hours, so has the state of Telangana. You know, I get called, the reverse is happening, so it's actually kind of interesting to be put on the other side of things. So it's not about the day-to-day, but India still hasn't made clear the guidelines for what it means to license a vaccine. What efficacy parameters are you going to use? And FDA and WHO have published those guidelines. I know India is still working on the guidelines, but they haven't been published. This is really important because then you measure every vaccine with the same yardstick, and then you ensure safety. So I think we immediately need those guidelines to be put in place, because manufacturers have a goal. Is it immunogenicity? Is it fourfold increase? Or do you expect efficacy, like WHO does expect efficacy? And what is that need is not being made clear. And the third challenge, I would say, is really this issue of allocation, which I touched upon. And that issue of allocation is not just a pull mechanism, but it's extremely important in the context of India contributing to the global equity, to global equitable access. And I just want to sign off by saying that from our standpoint, our philosophy has been that we ensure equitable access. For us, all children are created equal, and we want to make sure that the price of the vaccine doesn't come in the way of a country making a decision to adopt the vaccine. We will do everything possible to make sure the country is incentivized to adopt the vaccine. Now, when it comes to institutional challenges, they're more fundamental. we don't have enough clinical trial sites and infrastructure in the country to rapidly deploy 15 different vaccines into different clinical trial cohorts. We don't have access to discovery-related infrastructure. Like right now, to do the non-human primate challenge studies, all of us are standing in line, and that's very hard to access. And the third one is the regulatory framework. I heard someone refer to this in an article calling it the bureaucratic cholesterol. So we need some kind of anticoagulants to unblock that bureaucratic cholesterol in the long term to be very effective.
I've heard many things, but I've never heard bureaucratic cholesterol. That's interesting. I'm going to use this term a bit more now. Thank you. No, not at all. In fact, I think it's some plain speak is sometimes much, much required than what we would like to believe. Thank you. Thank you very much for that perspective. And another take home for me is, you said all children are created equal. I think all humans, all children, all of us are created equal. It's just that the access and the affordability piece, I think that is what has been a huge challenge. Now, let's go to Anand. Anand, a lot of times people assume that since you're named Indian Immunologicals, you're actually owned by the government. But but I think you should give us a perspective of how your experience has been in dealing with the regulatory framework, the regulatory roadblocks, etc. Tell us what needs to change. Tell us how a state can be your partner in terms of ensuring that your voice is heard in Delhi and action is taken, especially in these testing times.
Thanks a lot. And first, let me start by saying that there has not been one meeting in the country. There are only 7 serious vaccine manufacturers in the country. There's not been one meeting held where all these 7 people have been brought together into one room and tried to even understand where we are related to in terms of R&D. And see, the country has a lot of infrastructure built in terms of science, but they're all in silos. You have a lot of academic research institutes across the country, but then you have vaccine manufacturers. There's not been any attempt to bring them all together. In the sense that if this was done, then probably we could, as Mahima said, today, even for small testing, we have to send outside the country for testing. But we have within India, we have a lot of the research institutes which belong to DBT and CSR, which could come and help us in terms of providing various, in terms of developing any test methods or helping us with some process development issues. So that kind of bringing together all the vaccine manufacturers along with some leading academic institutes would to an extent help us a lot. Next is Mahima touched upon funding. As you said, we don't see any pull mechanism because each of us, as of now, we are just trying to spend from our own pockets, not even knowing like how much of this is going to be taken up later. And so there has to be some kind of a mechanism which would at least help us de-risk in this funding mechanism. The third is the regulatory, which Dr. Ella talked about. True that today, under normal circumstances itself, reaching out to the regulatory authorities is very difficult. And now, especially in COVID times, it's not easy, feasible for us to travel to Delhi as frequently as we did. So if some kind of a decentralization of that can happen, especially if some of those authorities can be given to Hyderabad, then that would definitely help us in our development process and also regulatory approval process.
Fantastic. In fact, I heard three words very clearly: decentralize, funding, and be flexible. These are the three messages, I think, for the government from the industry. I think these three things, if we can take care of, I think more and more can happen. I don't know if we still have Dr. Swaminathan with us. Is she on, Shakti? Is she still with us? Dr. Swaminathan, I'm not sure if you're with us. If you are, ma'am, I'd like to ask you one quick question. Or before she joins us, in fact, we can possibly have, you know, another question taken as well. Mahima, one of the things, again, that was discussed during the course of the discussion today is about capacities. Now, like you mentioned 80 to 100 million doses per month that potentially can be manufactured as and when you get the approval after phase 3. We are a country of 1.3 billion people. I think the entire country is looking at vaccine manufacturers with a great deal of anticipation. How do you see the timelines in terms of rollout, in terms of how our capacities can be expanded, et cetera, and how quickly can we ramp up to cover, firstly, obviously, the most vulnerable, and then maybe cover all sets of people across the country? How do you see that panning out?
So this really would vary from technology to technology, sir, because some technologies have inherent limitations. So cell culture-based technologies are harder to scale. So for instance, if you're in cell cubes or cell factories, then you need to adopt to fermentation to be able to scale much more rapidly and quicker. So there's one on the drug substance side, what we call the upstream side. And I think on the upstream side, the only way to scale in a time-bound fashion is to collaborate and to look to contract manufacturing capacity and so on and so forth. Because to set up a drug substance facility from scratch is going to take a minimum of 18 months. And I'm being extremely optimistic by saying it's 18 months. So that's not going to happen. So the only way is to look at, you know, who has microbial fermentation facilities? Who has cell culture facilities? How quickly can I collaborate? And if you see the AstraZeneca model, that's exactly what they've done. They have a manufacturing site in US, in Europe, and in India. So when we think about it, we need to think, you know, more locally as well as globally to look at how we expand drug substance. In our case, we would be able to deploy other infrastructure or other programs, assuming that it doesn't cause a disruption to routine immunization. We could deploy other infrastructure to do campaigning. But one thing that remains common as an infrastructure that everybody needs is going to be fill-finish capacity. Today, one of the big concerns is, will there be enough glass tubing? Will there be enough vials in which you put the vaccine? You know, we really haven't had this scale of expansion or need for vials ever before. So for even the back-end support manufacturers to be able to supply materials is still going to be a challenge, something that we'll have to see, so such that they are not allocating to the highest bidder, so to speak, right? But the one infrastructure that's common to all of us is fill-finish infrastructure, because majority of these vaccines, barring a few which are nasal sprays or attempting to be nasal sprays, they're all injectables. And creating that additional fill-finish infrastructure right now will enable us to deliver those 8 billion doses in the most rapid fashion possible, because that will be rate-limiting at one point, where the drug substance can be scaled, but you won't be able to fill it in vials. So from a manufacturing perspective, we're trying to do everything we can by looking at 20-dose presentation, 30-dose, having preservatives that, you know, will take us through a much larger vial. But what I've been, you know, trying to advocate for, particularly with DBT and such, including CEPI, is to say create a fund where people can access money to expand their fill-finish infrastructure. And why is this a good thing? There's no downside risk. Even if your vaccine candidate doesn't work, you can ensure that that infrastructure is deployed for whichever vaccine candidate that works. So, you know, it's not a win or lose situation for the government to make a bet on. But these are very critical to be able to rapidly scale. And the third thing, and very important factor, is availability of trained manpower. Right now, we envision creating an additional 500 jobs within the next 6 months. But we really need skilled workforce, and that's a long-term thing as well. But these three things will enable us to rapidly scale.
Thank you, Mahima. In fact, I think it's not a zero-sum game, is what Mahima says from the government perspective. Krishna, before you know, we get to Dr. Swaminathan, who will possibly join us a bit. She's gone? Okay. Before we go to her, or I think it looks like it, she's left us. But equitable distribution. I know you are on the verge of phase three, possibly end of this month. So since we are looking at you with a great deal of optimism, how do we ensure as a country, 1.3 billion people, we know your abilities to manufacture, we know that there is always a limitation, certain cap on how much you can manufacture. How do we ensure that this equitable distribution just doesn't remain in the paper, and like Mahima said, the highest bidder? Because I've heard you in other webinars where you said, you know, Chinese government came in and blocked the entire South American market on some other vaccine development process. How do we ensure that, such a thing does not happen, and how do we ensure Hyderabad, you know, being the vaccine capital of the world, how do we ensure we assert our position? How do we ensure we not only supply for India, we also manufacture and supply to the rest of the world in a very equitable fashion? How do we do that?
I just want to blame the government for that matter, honestly. The reason is the government is looking at it more on a health point of view, COVID problem. But I consider it's an economic point of view. If somebody is starving with the loss of a job and loss starving, he's going to die. That's much worse. And the WHO and the Indian government, the drug controller, looks at what is 1% adverse reactions and all that. But they're not looking at it, how do we deploy faster? And it is possible. Technology now, new technologies, and all the manufacturers, we have all the quality control systems in place. There's nothing that we're short-circuit anything. But I think government has to sit in the central government and call the manufacturers, tell me what you want. Each one is, they're working in compartment. They say, we are fast track. But all put together, no fast track in the country. So literally, it is an isolation. Each one want to look at microscope. How come this Indian company can develop this COVID vaccine? Let me look at it. If it comes from US, no scrutiny, much. But I think that system has to be put now. Our chief minister has to put a pressure on the prime minister's office. Something the drug controller and DBT, all of them, principal secretary should stick together, call the manufacturers, quick strategy discussion, and how do we execute? There must be one leader there should be executed. If it is done, honestly, I'm telling you, all the four manufacturers, three from here, Serum, can feed the entire 1.2 billion. Coming to affordability, trust me, I'm telling you, we are lesser than water bottle costs of vaccines. So water bottle is more expensive.
I'm sure vaccine wouldn't be as much, 330 ml.
So this is five times more expensive than your vaccine. So we are really affordable. I think we are the lowest in the world. And the best quality, trust me, I'm telling you, our quality of a vaccine, Indian manufacturer's quality of vaccine, and GSK and Sanofi is exactly the same. Please keep in mind, we follow exactly WHO, TRS, and US FDA guidelines, nothing less. People think Indian vaccine means something low quality. No, all are same quality. There's only one quality in vaccine field. There's no two quality. So only one quality, be assured of that. And I think, you know, there's some strategic discussion missing, leadership is missing in Delhi to take on. Quickly sit together and put a strategy. Chinese, what they've done, they've given $1 billion to Mexico, blocking the entire Latin American market. They went to Egypt, they're blocking the African market. I really think in 5 years, the Gavi may not exist, UNICEF also may not exist. The way Chinese going and dominating the country's market. It's very scary.
Krishna, in fact, I agree with you on two things here. First thing I think is, Government of India really needs to take all stakeholders, including the states and the manufacturers, into confidence, strategize together. Instead of saying just 1 billion doses over a period of so many days or months or so many weeks, we need to strategize on not only on vaccine distribution, but also when we go into that phase where we have to test larger population. I think we need strategies, we need to test all corners of the country, and we need to ensure that the vaccine is made available. Secondly, on Krishna's point, I can vouch for it because I have been to his lab today on the, you know, biosafety level 3, BSL 3, a standard lab. Not just a lab, in fact, the manufacturing facility. I'm told it's one of its kind in the world, not just in India, but it's one of its kind in the world. I am delighted and thrilled, you know, to have witnessed something of that caliber and that standard in Hyderabad. I'm sure other labs are also, you know, labs are of BSL 3 level. But manufacturing at BSL 3 level is also something that is truly unique. So we can certainly compete in terms of quality, in terms of cost, in terms of scale with everybody else in the world. So I also agree with you on the fact that we need to possibly position ourselves, brand ourselves, and talk up in the sense of Government of India and the state governments promoting you and, you know, encouraging the local manufacturers. Now, Anand, on this issue of equitable distribution. I've heard Prime Minister Modi talk about how we could possibly, how we should possibly start planning now to distribute this vaccine to the large, you know, population of our country. What are your thoughts? And then we go to final comments from each of us, each of you.
As you rightly said, like we need to ponder on this. It's not just developing a vaccine. And then how do we address this 1 billion population who have to be immunized? Because it, from a child to a senior citizen has to be given this vaccine. So in terms of, see, each company, currently what we do is, like, we have certain manufacturing capacity for existing vaccines. Like, say, we produce various kinds of vaccines for the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. And then what now we are doing is some of those spare capacities is what we are going to use for when this COVID vaccine candidate comes. So we are going to use some of the spare capacities that we have. So the amount of spare capacity that exists in each of the vaccine manufacturers, that is not determined yet. I mean, even if any vaccine, like say if Dr. Ella was to develop the Covaxin, and if there's additional capacity required, so far no attempts have been made to even understand how much spare capacities are available with other manufacturers. Now that I heard from Mahima that they're going to produce like 80 million doses a month, and they are worried about their inability to fill finish. I'm happy to offer, we have put a brand new fill finish facility just 7-8 kilometers from here, which can fill 200 million doses if it is a 10 dose vial, and if it is a 20 dose vial, it will be much more than that.
You guys, need to meet more often, I think.
So some kind of a dialogue among vaccine manufacturers should happen, because it's not about a race as to who comes out with the vaccine first, who makes the most money, or it's not about that. It's like, how do we address, I mean, if you see in terms of the size, today you see the polio vaccine program is supposed to be the biggest, but that's catering to only 27 million. But today you're talking about a billion people, and what mechanism is there in case if a candidate comes, how are you going to mass produce? And then how are you also going to distribute across? And if it's going to be a vaccine which has to be stored at minus 70 or beyond, then really we lack the infrastructure for those kind of things. So I think some high-level planning at the center has to happen to ensure speedy development, also adequate distribution across the country.
Well, I can't speak for center, but I assure you of this. We will plan for our state. We'll plan for, because, you know, you guys are manufacturing right here. I think it's only a matter of local pride, and also a matter of social responsibility that we also take care of the state that we're working in. So I certainly promise you this, that we will strategize for our state, our health department, and our Honorable Chief Minister, of course, has been talking about it, but I think a well-laid plan needs to be in place in terms of ensuring the infrastructure to even store, like you pointed out, Anand, the vaccines, and also distribution. How do we do it? Pan entire 4 crore people, that needs to be planned. Now, since this is the first time all three of you are coming together onto a platform, we did a little bit of a survey. I tweeted, I said, you know, what are the questions that you would like answers to, etc. The one question that came on tops, which I think you all can guess, that will be the last question for all three of you. See, it's like looking at a crystal maze and answering this one. Maybe you have more solid basis and solid grounding to answer this than any of us in this room right here. We'll start with Mahima. The question that is on everybody's mind: when is the vaccine likely to come out, right? And how long is it going to be effective for? I think it's a tough question, I know, but I think I would want your educated, because since you're in this, since you've been in this business for decades, I want a very simple, to the point answer on when do you think it'll happen and how do you think it's going to pan out from there on?
Between Q1 next year and Q3 next year, you should start to see at least 5 candidates get licensed.
Q1 and Q3,
yeah.
That is January,
anywhere between the third quarter.
Anywhere
in the world.
Anywhere in the world,
yeah.
Of course.
Yeah. So I think that. How long, really, the epidemiology of the virus is not known. So will it be a seasonal, like a flu shot that you have to take every year because it's mutated enough that it warrants redevelopment? Or is there enough persistence to last a year? Now, one of the trade-offs is everybody wants a single-dose vaccine because it's easy to administer. Now, all single-dose vaccines may not be as persistent. So it's really a trade-off between number of doses, persistence, and all of that. Time will tell. I'm afraid I couldn't predict anything on persistence at this
point. Q1 to Q3, and you're saying it could either be in the form of a annual shot like for flu, or it could be a, depending on
could be
the epidemiology,
years,
could be a 5 years.
Depends. We won't... Typically, we would have done this all before licensure, but given the risk we're doing, you know, we're going ahead in licensing. So we'll only know post-licensure of a vaccine how long the duration of protection lasts.
All right. Thank you. And let's go to Anand. Anand, Mahima says Q1 to Q3 next year. And Mahima also says it could be, depending on the epidemiology of the virus, it could vary.
See, as I said, we have taken the most technology challenging route to this particular vaccine candidate development. I mean, bearing in mind that when it comes as a successful candidate, that it offers tremendous advantages over other vaccines, because one, the cost will be low. Next is it would provide lifelong immunity, which we hope that would do with a single dose. And we are hoping that somewhere between, because it's a live attenuated codon deoptimized vaccine, we are hoping that somewhere between Q2 to Q3, we should have something in our hand.
Q2 to Q3. And you're saying that your vaccine will have a potentially longer impact and it will be more affordable.
Yeah, because it stimulates, there's a lot of published literature how a live attenuated vaccine works, because it stimulates both humoral and cell mediated immunity, and also a very good memory as well. So we are hoping that one or at the most two shots will protect for lifetime.
Thank you, Anand. Krishna, we'll let you have the final word. I know you're working on three different vaccines in three different parts of the world. Tell us what you believe is going to come out first. Also tell us how you see this remaining effective and the efficacy of the vaccine per se. How do you see that also helping us?
I think, you know, globally by next year, at least 10 to 15 vaccines will be there in the market, different platform. But this is the first time cancer biologists are getting into the vaccine field. This is very surprising things we're seeing, the transition. And now they are bringing their adjuvant, their strategy of immunity is bringing into the vaccine field now, first time. So what we have is right now is the Th2 response. And now people are realizing Th2 is no use. We need Th1 cell-mediated response. That's a good sign, already figured out that. So when you have that figured out, now adjuvant will come in, live vaccines, other things will come in, and that will take place right now. And people will figure out whether maybe live combined with inactivated, inactivated with live, all these combinations will come out. By next year, they'll figure out the science. And I'm not I'm very optimistic, because the intensity of the research, first time I've seen so many companies getting in, and the immunology will build up. See, something earlier, immunology was working separately, vaccine field was working separately. This is the first time I'm seeing integration of the both right now. And I'm very optimistic that you're going to see, and people are going to follow whatever, whoever, suppose we vaccinate the phase one trial, we're going to monitor them next 2-3 years. And we have done typhoid conjugate, we monitored 5 years, it's gone down, then immediately we shot with another booster, again shot it up. So we follow them, those people. It's not that the clinical trial is over, we left off the patients. We're going to monitor them continuously. And when it goes down, we're going to understand again science. So clinical research is going to be an important field right now in this, more than the biological R&D angle. More than R&D, it's going to be clinical research, which is going to tell us a lot of things.
Understand. But the dates that you're looking at, the timelines that you're looking at?
I think the media is there. I don't want to comment. I'm very scared of that.
Well, we've said enough for them to cover. But listen, the good news is this. The good news, I believe, is that there will be a vaccine. Now, that's what the industry seems to think. That's what they're confident about. Now, the not-so-good news is that we may have to wait. We may have to wait for another 6 months or 9 months or 12 months, depending on whose perspective and what prism you're looking through. So, therefore, we have to ensure, as Dr. Soumya Swaminathan pointed out so eloquently, she said the new normal, the new way of life that we all have to get used to, the physical distancing, the masking, the ensuring that we sanitize, ensuring that we don't pass the infection, ensure that the governments test, and also continue to isolate, continue to flatten the curve as we've been talking about for a while. All of these things are points that you will keep hearing over and over the next few months. Once again, I compliment the entire life sciences ecosystem in the state of Telangana, and particularly in Genome Valley here. You guys are, like I said earlier today at Bharat Biotech, you guys are no less than the frontline warriors, because you've been exposing yourself to these viruses, these microbes, which potentially have a huge detrimental effect on your health. But you've been fighting this battle, and you give us that ray of hope. You give us that absolute faith that, you know, positive things are around the corner. So my compliments to the entire life sciences ecosystem in Genome Valley. Once again, I'd like to thank Dr. Soumya Swaminathan, who joined us from Geneva, the chief scientist of World Health Organization, and Mahima Datlo of Biologically for joining us. Ma'am, thank you. I was just about thanking you, but I have one last question before we sign off. One last question. Ma'am, you've done extensive work in tuberculosis. Your research is, considered pioneering and benchmarking. I'm sure your expertise and your experience with tuberculosis definitely also, you know, gives you a lot of positive inputs going down further in view of COVID as well. One question I do have. As World Health Organization's chief scientist, how can you ensure that there is no hoarding? You know, how can we ensure that vaccine, whenever it comes up, how do we ensure that it doesn't go to the highest bidder, like you pointed out during SARS and H1N1? Some countries have hoarded only when they've realized that the epidemic is not as strong as they thought it would be. Only then they decided to, be generous and share it with other developing nations. How can we ensure that the most deserving, most needy, irrespective of their geographic location, get the vaccine ahead of anybody else, and then it goes on in that order of priority? How can WHO play a pivotal role in working with various governments across the world? And how can we in India and how can we in Telangana also possibly play a role, active role, along with WHO in ensuring that this process is expedited for the benefit of humanity?
Thank you for this very interesting session that I was following. The last question you asked me is actually a very good one, and one that I think everyone has to ask themselves. Ultimately, it is the 194 countries of members of the World Health Organization that need to come together and take a decision on which way they want to proceed. Equitable and fair distribution of vaccines and other health products that are being developed for COVID. One of the things that we launched in May is something called the CTAP, that is the COVID Technology Access Pool. This is to encourage governments as well as companies to pool their technologies and intellectual properties, anything related to COVID. It also includes data, research, knowledge, but could also include patents on vaccines and on drugs. And we hope that this technology access pool will be a mechanism for people to be able to share their discoveries and share their knowledge freely so that more people can be benefited. And we have seen this happen actually in a large number of cases. People have actually created something and said, this is for use and benefit of the public at large. When it comes to drugs and vaccines, which are developed mostly by private companies, things become a little more complex. And the usual practice is for those companies to retain IP. So we have to see here whether we can change that paradigm. And even if IP is retained, there should be technology sharing. Because in the case of vaccines, it's really a question of the know-how. And finally, it's the political leaders who will make the decisions, because every country is governed by their own laws and, their own leaders, their parliament or governance structures. And they can take decisions which are a sovereign right. So the hope really here is that they put the global needs above their own national needs, since the virus does not respect borders. And we know that the economic fallout globally is so huge, it's like running into trillions of dollars every month, that the amount of investment to both develop and distribute a vaccine going to be in billions. We're asking for about $30 billion for the COVAX pillar in order to develop and distribute vaccines to the whole world. So it's only a fraction of the actual economic losses which are occurring because of COVID. And even if one country is able to protect their entire population, it's not going to help because the infection is going to keep moving and traveling between countries as we have seen. So it is in everybody's self-interest to ensure that there is sort of a global access to whatever tools are being developed. So let us hope that the global solidarity takes precedence over vaccine nationalism. And so what we would like to see is solidarity and vaccine multilateralism, where wherever, regardless of where vaccine is developed, whichever country, it's made available to the world based on some of the criteria that we had talked about earlier. And I'm sure that India would be a leader in that philosophy and that goal. The Prime Minister has often spoken about innovating for not only Indians, but for the world. And so we should actually be in the forefront of advocating for this and also for following this principle and helping other leaders also take the right decision. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you so much for joining us and thanks for taking the time out and actually giving us sharing a lot of thoughts with us. Once again, I promise all three of you, the industry leaders here, that we will continue to champion this angle of decentralized fund and also be flexible in terms of our regulatory framework with Government of India. We will be your advocate from state government in ensuring that your voice is heard and the life sciences ecosystem in Hyderabad and Telangana is further strengthened. So thank you very much, Dr. Swaminathan. Thank you, Mahima. Thank you, Anand. And thank you, Krishna, once again for joining us. Look forward to strengthening and augmenting our ecosystem here. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Cheers.
Bye-bye.
How are you?
Very, very good, ma'am. Very good. We have Mahima Datla, we have Dr. Krishna Ella, and we have Anand Kumar, all of us. And of course, you've been here in Genome Valley in 2017, February, about 3 years ago, 3.5 years ago.
Yes.
I'm told you're in Geneva, ma'am.
I remember that visit very well to the Genome Valley.
Oh, thank you.
And visiting several of the companies who are there.
Fantastic. Ma'am, we'll get started whenever you're ready. So, can we get started?
Yes, I'm ready.
And you're going to be with us for what, 45 minutes, 1 hour? Depending on that, we'll structure the flow. Yeah?
45 minutes, I can stay.
All right, thank you. Thank you so much. So, good afternoon to Dr. Soumya Swaminathan, who's the Chief Scientist of World Health Organization. She is somebody who's very familiar with the life sciences ecosystem of India, of course, and also the life sciences ecosystem of Telangana and Hyderabad, and more particularly Genome Valley, which is right here. She was, in fact, she obviously, like I pointed out just now, she had visited Genome Valley in 2017, about three plus years ago, and we also have had a couple of interactions with her when she was heading ICMR. And just a pleasure and delight to have you, ma'am, with us. Thank you very much for joining us, and thank you very much for your time. We have with us Mahima Datla of Biological E. We have Anand Kumar of Indian Immunologicals, and we also have Dr. Krishna Ella of Bharat Biotech. As we all know, this is an unprecedented time. These are uncharted waters for all of us, in fact, without an exception. So this is an exciting time also from the perspective of, you know, just believing that every adversity has an inherent opportunity that lies within. And today, Hyderabad and our life sciences ecosystem here is truly fortified its position, has really shown its strength to the world, not only from our pharmaceutical sector, but also from our biotechnology and vaccine manufacturing, facilities in Hyderabad. I'm proud to share with you that Hyderabad continues to remain, you know, one of the leaders in vaccine manufacturing. We, in fact, today manufacture more than one-third vaccines that are used globally. And we also have, in fact, like I pointed out, been home to pharma companies which have been producing the drugs such as Remdesivir, Flavipiravir, etc., which have all been in use in the last few months. Delighted that Hyderabad's ecosystem, more particularly the three companies which are right here with us, are leading the vaccine race. There are more than 150 vaccines that are currently under development at various stages across the world. But within India, we have six companies that are in the race. And out of those six, I'm proud to share with you, four of them actually are headquartered in Hyderabad. And three of them are sitting right here with us. So I'm here more to learn from them. I'm here more to understand from them, like every other layman out there in India and elsewhere, on what is happening in today's world and what is happening in the vaccine manufacturing and also other developments with respect to COVID and this pandemic. We'll get started, with Dr. Swaminathan. Did we lose her? Dr. Swaminathan? Swamyaji? We'll get started with you, ma'am. Ma'am, you'll have to unmute yourself. We'll get started with you.
Yeah.
Ma'am, just a quick, initial thoughts. A lot of data, a lot of research, a lot of articles these days, you know, with WhatsApp and, you know, social media being all pervasive, everybody seems to know everything. But let me get it from the chief scientist of World Health Organization. How long do you think we have to learn to live with this? Because I think that realization has dawned upon all of us that we have to coexist with the virus for a bit. But how long do you think we have to live with this? How long do you think we have to coexist? How do you see the future panning out over the next few months at least?
Yes. No. Thank you very much, Minister. First of all, congratulations on organizing this program today. I think it's very timely. The discussion on vaccines really needs to happen at different levels, both globally and nationally. I'd like to tell you a little bit about what we are doing and how we are thinking about it, and also answer your question about how long will this last and what else should we be doing. Maybe I can start with that. We know now that this novel coronavirus has established itself in the world. It has gone into practically every country, and wherever it has found a situation where it's able to spread easily from person to person, it has established community transmission, and it just goes through the population because we do not have much of pre-existing immunity to this. Now, I will add a caveat there because we are still learning about the immunity to this virus. It is possible that previous exposure to some other coronaviruses might offer some protection. That is one of the questions which are still open and can only be answered if we study cohorts of people right through and establish cohorts and see who are the people who get more severe infection versus less severe infection. Why do children appear to be relatively less susceptible to disease. They do get the infection, but they don't get sick most of the time. And why is it that with increasing age and with some of the comorbidities, we see increasing severity and increasing mortality? And how long is the immunity going to last after natural infection? We know now that most people who have natural infection develop neutralizing antibodies, and they also seem to develop T cell immunity. So both the cellular and the humoral immune system is activated. But what we don't know is when do these antibodies start reducing, and for how long is there protective immunity? And this has implications for vaccines. If long-lasting immunity cannot be achieved after a natural infection, with the vaccine, again, we'll have to see. Because the vaccine is targeting, right now, all the vaccines are targeting the spike protein. The first-generation vaccines are all targeting the spike protein because it's the most immunogenic protein of the virus. The only risk is if the virus develops a mutation which causes it to escape the immunity, which is conferred by the antibodies against the spike protein, then we are in a difficulty. So the second-generation vaccine is actually targeting other antigens as well. So we need also backup plans. And the second thing which we can only do when we introduce the vaccine into phase 3 trials and follow people is to see how long is the immunity going to last, the protective immunity. Whether it's a sterilizing immunity or it's only a disease-modifying immunity, both types could happen with different vaccine candidates. So the message I would like to give right at the beginning is that for the foreseeable future, at least for the next 12 months, we need to put in place the public health and social measures that have been shown to work. And this is at the level of the government, the community, and the individual. Most countries who have controlled the virus successfully in the first phase have been because of good governance, good strategic planning based on scientific knowledge and based on evidence, and because of involvement of community and individual trust, good communication between the government and the people, clear communication, and being prepared to manage what is likely to happen in the future. We know that lockdowns are a temporary measure, which reduces the spread because you prevent people from getting close together. And the idea of the lockdown was to buy time for the government to put in place the systems needed to tackle the virus. And I strongly believe, and the WHO has been repeatedly emphasizing the fact, that testing is extremely important. Unless we test adequately, we don't know where the virus is. And Dr. Tedros once used the phrase, fighting a fire blindfolded. If you do not test, it's like fighting a fire blindfolded. We have to test and test and test. But testing alone is not going to solve the problem. It's the first step. That, of course, has to be followed by isolation of positive people, contact tracing, quarantining, taking care of those who are positive, following them to make sure that they don't get into the interstitial pneumonia and complications by monitoring their oxygen saturation. So it's a comprehensive package which needs to be put in place, particularly in those places where there is a high density of population, so the cities, for example. In the rural areas, it would be good to have some kind of a surveillance going on so that you know what is going on. This surveillance is usually done in the form of influenza-like illness surveillance or severe acute respiratory illness surveillance, what we call as ILI and SARI surveillance. If everybody who comes in with symptoms suggestive of influenza or of pneumonia is also tested for COVID-19, apart from other infections, like you can do a combined influenza COVID test, then you have a sort of a constant surveillance going on in the rural areas to know which districts, which villages are seeing infections going up. But in the cities, the only way out is to expand testing. India as a whole, the testing rates are much lower compared to some of the countries who have done well, like Germany, Taiwan, South Korea, Japan. Even the United States is testing a huge number of people every day. So we need to have some benchmarks. And every public health department needs to have benchmarks on what is the rate of testing per lakh or per million. What is the test positivity rate? The moment your test positivity rate is above 5%, you know that we are not testing adequately. And then also looking constantly and monitoring the availability of beds, the availability of quarantine facilities, the availability of ICU, oxygen availability in the district hospitals, and so on. So there is a set of about 8 to 10 indicators that the government needs to keep a close watch on. And you can ramp up and ramp down based on what you're seeing on the ground. And the other thing is about the communication to people and what people have to do. It's very nice to see everyone wearing a mask. And I must say, I've been impressed in Chennai also, where the mask compliance seems to be very, very high. I'm not sure what it is in the rural areas or in the districts. We need to keep on, because I think wearing a mask properly and using a mask properly is also something people need to learn. If the mask is hanging down below the nose or mouth, it's not going to be effective. But modeling has shown that if everyone wears a mask, you can really cut down on transmission. So it's really a very affordable, cost-effective, and effective measure for people. The other thing is, of course, maintaining distance as far as possible. In some situations, it's less possible because of slum areas and things like that. And also, we know where the clusters can happen. These happen in closed environments where people spend time together. So that is why you have to limit the number of people. But you have industries, factories, other kinds of places, even offices, where people just have to go because you have to restart your economy. That is where then you need to, again, to have a surveillance mechanism, temperature monitoring, making sure everybody's masked, making sure that people maintain the distance, that they have the respiratory etiquette, etc. So it's a very painstaking process, all of these steps, if they have to be implemented properly, but they do bear fruit and they do give results if done. Now, over to vaccines, because that's what everybody is looking at as an exit strategy from the pandemic. Let's hope that several of the vaccine candidates in testing, today there are 27, I think, or 28 vaccines that are in clinical trials, and another 150-odd which are in preclinical testing. At least 5 are now entering phase 3 trials. So we will know in the next few months about the safety and efficacy of these vaccines. And I emphasize safety as very important, because to get public trust, when you're going to vaccinate huge numbers of healthy individuals, the safety bar of the vaccine has to be set quite high in order for it to be acceptable and usable in the population. So things like the disease enhancement, which is something which has happened previously with other vaccines, and other rare side effects that you notice only when tens of thousands of people have been vaccinated, those have to be really followed up. So one of the things we need to prepare for is a pharmacovigilance strategy and mechanisms, not just during the clinical trial, but after licensure and after it starts getting used widely. We need to keep an eye for the next couple of years on the safety profile of this vaccine. Efficacy, of course, is important, and the WHO has already put out guidance on what we consider as acceptable efficacy. So it would be good to have a vaccine with at least 70% efficacy, minimum of 50%, but with a lower bound of efficacy not falling below 30%. Because modeling has shown that anything below 50% efficacious vaccine is not going to have much of a public health impact. So that's the kind of a benchmark that we hope for. Now, through the ACT Accelerator that WHO launched on April 24th with many, many partners, what we are hoping to do is to speed up the R&D for vaccines, therapeutics, and diagnostics, but also ensure equitable access. So it's not just a question of faster development, but also of fair and equitable access to populations around the world. We do not want to be in a situation which happened during the H1N1 pandemic 2009-10, when a few rich countries bought most of the supplies and stocks of vaccines and only started donating it to the lower income countries when they realized that infection probably wasn't as serious or severe as it was supposed to be, and they had excess stocks. Now, if that happens again this time, then I think all of us would have failed. What we hope to do is to, as vaccines become available, to distribute them across the world to protect those who are the most vulnerable, the frontline workers, the health workers, the others who are at highest risk of getting infection, then the vulnerable group within the community, and then go to the rest of the population as the stocks become more and more available. So the COVAX initiative, which is WHO, CEPI, and Gavi, aims to have 2 billion doses of the vaccine by end of 2021. A realistic timeline to start getting the first millions of doses would be the first half of 2021. But then will come the distribution, the delivery, and then for countries to be able to start vaccinating their populations. This is something that ministries are already looking at. They are drawing up their policies. They're looking at supply chain and other logistics that will be needed. One of the things we don't know is which vaccine will be successful and what the storage conditions will be. There are a couple of vaccines which need to be stored at minus 70 or minus 80. Others, hopefully, at 4 to 8 degrees. So we have to be prepared for those. And we have to get agreement between countries. In the next few weeks, actually, we need to get agreement that they will follow the fair allocation mechanism that's being developed by WHO. Side by side, the COVAX facility is being set up by Gavi. This is a risk pooling mechanism where self-financing countries can put in some funds so that they can procure vaccines for their populations. And they are pooling the risk because the COVAX facility will buy vaccines which are going to be proven to be safe and efficacious. And at the same time, the ODA funds will pay for the vaccines which will go to the Gavi-eligible countries. The number of Gavi-eligible countries has been increased now to 92. India, of course, is a Gavi-eligible country, and so should be getting the vaccine doses from the COVAX facility. But India being a hub of manufacturing could also consider how and they are going to really interact with the rest of the world and with the COVAX facility in terms of sharing of the vaccines that are going to be produced in India, and a lot of them are going to be produced in Hyderabad.
Yes, ma'am. In fact,
we are fortunate that Mahima is on the panel. She's on the board for the COVAX facility. There's a coordinating mechanism, and she represents the Developing Country Vaccine Manufacturers Association. So we have a strong voice from India on that board as we shape it up and as it moves. As I said, the next few weeks are going to be quite critical. Over to you, Minister.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. In fact, like you pointed out, India continues to remain a hub for vaccine manufacturing. And within India, Telangana and Hyderabad have been, on the forefront. And today, like I pointed out, more than one third of global vaccines are produced from Genome Valley in Hyderabad. So we're very proud, and all the very, very pertinent points you made. Thank you very much. But one quick thing before I turn, quick question before I turn to the panel here, of the industry leaders. Yesterday, I had read a statement from the World Health Organization chief saying that while a vaccine you know, the hope for a vaccine is very real and it might happen, there is also an equal chance that there could never be a vaccine. Can you help us understand this? Because, you know, vaccine in current situation seems to be a ray of hope, but there must be a reason, there must be a logic. I'm sure the industry here will never, you know, possibly agree with whatever was said, but nevertheless, help us understand why or what would prompt someone to say, like in the case of HIV, how there could never be a vaccine. In case of COVID as well, it was pointed out yesterday that there also is a chance, however fat or slim it is, that there could never be a vaccine. Is that a fair reasoning, fair thought process? What are your thoughts?
So I think the experts who are sitting with you know very well that vaccine development is a risky business and that success is not assured. We have many diseases for which we don't have vaccines, in spite of a lot of R&D having been done over decades, like HIV, TB, malaria, etc. We have so far not had a vaccine for a coronavirus. So this is a new endeavor. So we are optimistic because of the efforts going into it and because of the number of different platforms that are being tested. But we haven't understood the virus completely. And so there is always a possibility that we don't get it right or that it takes longer. We may not get it right the first time. It may take longer. And that is why I think the DG is warning people, do not believe that the problem is going to be solved in 6 months or 12 months. We don't know that for sure. Unless we see results from the phase three efficacy trials, and unless we follow people up to see how long they are protected for, we really can't say that this problem is going to come to an end in 2021 or 2022. So I think he's preparing people to think longer term and to think about public health, vaccine being one part of the battle. It's, vaccine is not the silver bullet, I think is what he said. Drugs are also important, and new drugs are being also tested because that can bring down the severity, that can prevent death. So that's a very important one. And new diagnostics also, like the antigen detection tests, etc., saliva tests will help.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Now let me turn to you know, the industry leaders here. We'll start with Dr. Krishna Iyer of Bharat Biotech. As we talk about the race for vaccine development, as we talk about the efficacy of the vaccine, the longevity of its impact, et cetera, help me understand, because Norman, from a layman's perspective, I am a layman, I would love to understand this. Normally I hear that it would take anywhere from a few years to sometimes, in fact, sometimes even a decade to create and produce a vaccine, because there is a lot of science involved, there is a lot of trials involved, there is a lot of you know, practices involved to make sure that the drug is actually efficient, the vaccine is actually efficient and very, very long in terms of its impact as well. I hope you're not compromising on the science in this pursuit, in this race, you know, in this sort of a rat race, so to speak, of one against another. I hope the science of the vaccine development is not being compromised, is not being adversely impacted. Can you help us understand how you're able to overcome these, you know, typical timelines, etc., and how we are able to now already, because I've been to your facility, Bharat Biotech, in fact, Covaxin and other vaccines that you're currently developing are already nearly in the phase three stage. So help us understand how you're taking care of the science behind and ensuring the efficacy of the vaccine is also taken into account before we talk about a full-fledged launch. Help us understand, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Honorable Minister. And we are really proud of Soumya heading the WHO. I think first Indian and first woman candidate heading there. We are proud of you. And I think, you know, the vaccine field takes 14 to 15 years a vaccine to develop. So we are trying to develop in less than 18 months or 12 months in this vaccine. It's complicated. But at the same time, with the vaccine experience, we are also much more cautious. It's not that we are trying to make it a vaccine just to move it fast to the market, no. I think we are putting a lot of intensive research in all 360 degrees, and that is where the partnership is helping us
with US, WHO, everybody helping us to look at the criticality, the some of the scientific aspect of it, so that we don't short-circuit the science. That is not there. So we are much more rigorous today. But problem, as Swami has said, the virus is a new one. So to trying to, it's like a relationship. You need to build a relationship with the virus to understand how this virus behaves. Besides, the people's genetic makeup also is playing a role. As you said, we don't know whether we have all of us had a respiratory pathogen infection. That might be the reason why we have death rate less in this country compared to the Italy or Spain, where the high death rate. So we might have got a lot of other infections before respiratory pathogens. So I think, you know, we are not short-circuiting in any way the science. And I can tell you, our science is all critiqued by the global community, not by India alone. It's a global community. So rest assured that any of the Hyderabad company or Indian company will short-circuit on science on this matter. That I can assure them.
Thank you, Krishna. In fact, that's very comforting to hear, because, you know, while we are all actively wanting a very, very impactful vaccine coming out ASAP, possibly day after tomorrow or yesterday, in fact, the fact is we cannot afford to short-circuit, like you put, you know, the whole science behind vaccine development. Now, let me turn over to Mahima. As Dr. Swaminathan pointed out, you're in a very pivotal role right now, representing the developed countries in Gavi. And also, your company, Biologically, has been in vaccine development for more than nearly five decades now, and a very, very reputed organization which has known the science. Why don't you walk us through, because again, from a very layman perspective, there are multiple approaches to a vaccine. If there are 150 vaccines that are currently under preparation, etc., what are the different approaches the world is taking? What is the difference between the vaccine that you are currently engaged in vis-a-vis Indian Immunologicals or Covaxin of Bharat or say Serum Institute, etc.? Also talk us through possibly how has vaccine development evolved in the last 5 decades? Because you've been in this business for the last several decades. So talk us through how scientific developments have helped and possibly how that can be put to good use so that this expeditious delivery that people are anticipating for COVID can be fructified. No, thanks, Mahima. Cheers, yeah.
I don't know if you can hear me. Okay. So first of all, I think at the heart of it, vaccine development, to put it in really simplistic terms, is really giving your body a bacteria or a virus that's highly purified. So it's basically stimulating what would naturally be the way a disease would be contracted, but in a very controlled fashion, such that it's giving your body the ability and the time to raise antibodies and fight the infection naturally. And the reason it needs to be controlled is because it needs to be safe. You don't want a high viral load and so on. So at the crux of it, all vaccines aim to do what nature does itself. All the people recovering from COVID, you know, they're getting exposed to the virus and they're raising antibodies and they're getting protected. So this is a way of simulating that. So all vaccines aim to do that. If I had to classify vaccines into the categories that based on the technology platforms, currently I would classify them into 4. And I'm sorry if there's scientists in the audience, there might be 10, but the way I understand it in my head is into 4 buckets. So the first bucket is viral vaccines that are inactivated. These can be whole virions or the virus itself that's inactivated either chemically or through heat or through other mechanisms. And I believe Bharat Biotech's Covaxin follows that approach, as do several others. The second bucket, I would say, is protein vaccines. So these are the spike proteins, which is the spike on the corona, giving it its name. They're the RBD, the receptor binding domain-based proteins, which play a role in inhibiting the virus attaching itself to the ACE2 receptors in our body. So there's a whole host of vaccines that are targeting spike proteins or the RBD. The third bucket, I would say, also targets spike proteins or RBD. So effectively, it's a protein approach, but it's also driven by new vectors. either modified vaccine Ankaria or the Advac vectors, and so on. And the fourth bucket, I would say, is the other and really novel technologies, which are your DNA vaccines and RNA vaccines, which is basically like a messenger. It's like coding. It's aimed to deliver a code to your genes and to your RNA to start producing antibodies against the virus. And frankly, it's extremely interesting platform technology, extremely exciting. And I think, you know, DNA and RNA vaccines have been in development for close to 15 years now. But this is really an opportune moment to test that technology. But unlike human beings, not all vaccines are created equal. And each of these come with their own sets of challenges in order to develop, like Dr. Swaminathan pointed out. Some of the new DNA and RNA vaccines need to be kept in minus 70 degrees. Now, these are programmatically extremely challenging. But I do want to talk a little bit about, you know, what we're doing to, have an expeditious vaccine. And in many ways, I agree with Dr. Ella that while there's no trade-offs in science, we are collectively making some trade-offs, because in reality, you would expect a vaccine to be over 90% efficacious. But all of vaccine development, not just now, historically, has to be viewed in the context of risk. Now, when you had widespread polio, we agreed to take the risk that when you take OPV vaccine, 1 in X percentage get polio because of the vaccine. But that's because the risk of polio was so high. I think COVID is similar. The fact that WHO put out TPP requirements for 50 to 80% efficacy tells you the trade-off that we're willing to make, but never at the cost of safety, because the last thing you want to do is make a situation even worse. Now, coming to our own candidates, we've been working on an RBD protein candidate, and the expression system we're using is yeast, it's Pichia. It's tried and tested. We've made hundreds of million doses of hepatitis B on that platform. And I think much like ourselves, many companies are choosing platforms that they are familiar with, that they have infrastructure for. Because the key to speed is, you know, 150 candidates are not going to be able to make the vaccine in hundreds of millions of doses. And I think that's very key, to marry the technology with the infrastructure and the track record and capability. Now, our choice of RBD was dictated by the infrastructure match that would best allow us to make vaccine as quickly as possible. And so far, we're going to start phase one studies in September, but from the manufacturability perspective, we have enough data that assures us that we'll be in a position to produce 80 to 100 million doses a month of this vaccine from the get-go. I think that's crucial, because in the early years, you're going to have a demand-supply gap and allocations. Everybody is going to fight over it. So it's really important to be able to scale quickly. And when we talk about challenges, you know, we could discuss that. But in my mind, the reason it'll be expeditious is because we are making certain trade-offs in context of risk, but not in relation to safety. We may be making trade-offs in terms of the expectation on timing of protection, because we may say, hey, it's okay if it protects us for 1 year, we'll take it yearly as opposed to a lifetime, but really not at the cost of safety. And the second most important factor is having large-scale infrastructure that you can deploy these technologies into. I hope that
answers. No, absolutely. In fact, before we go to scale, before we talk about how, like Dr. Swaminathan pointed out, you know, some countries tend to hoard, then, you know, at the cost of developing nations, et cetera, before we go into that, I think one important question that, is currently sort of has been overlooked in the past but has come to the fore now is how competition, such as you, all three of you, or in fact other vaccine manufacturers in the country, including Serum and others, in a country like India, you know, where government doesn't spend too much on R&D, government per se does not spend a lot of money on research and development. Of course, we encourage private sector to invest in R&D. We encourage private sector, of course, to take the risk. And of course, the reward also will be that much higher. The fact is, this is the first time you three are sharing a podium or a platform, on a vaccine development or especially in light of COVID. Let me ask you, Anand, Indian Immunologicals again has a long track record. How do we ensure as a government, be it the Telangana government or be it government of India, how do we ensure that while you actively compete with each other, while you actively race up against each other in development of a vaccine, in pursuit of vaccine, isn't there scope for you to collaborate, work with each other, and also talk to each other, engage with each other, so that when humanity is faced with such a huge crisis, should we not be coming together more often as industry, as government, as competition, to collaborate and to come out with more coherent and synergistic strategies? Your thoughts on this, then we can go into other things.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for organizing a platform where at least three manufacturers who are supposed to be one of the largest in India to come together. As you rightly said, that COVID-19 has offered us a tremendous challenge, especially for all the vaccine manufacturers to come out with a candidate vaccine at a very, very rapid speed. We are, in fact, some of our companies are in talking terms with ITER to see if we can combine together to use our facilities. Here, actually, we don't call this as a rat race or something, because here, when humanity is at risk, we are always talking to each other to see that if we can agree on using our combined strength to bring about a vaccine at the fastest pace. In our case, we at Indian Immunologicals, there are various, as Dr. Soumya said, that there are various platforms being pursued. We have chosen a live attenuated codon deoptimized platform. The live attenuated codon deoptimized platform gives tremendous advantage for a country like ours. Especially, this vaccine needs to be administered right from children to senior citizens. So if the vaccine is going to be priced very high, then it's going to be totally unaffordable for any government. I heard one of our competitor vaccine companies saying that a vaccine will be priced at 1,000 rupees a dose. 1,000 rupees a dose for a country of our size. And if you want to achieve, let's say, even 70%, because 70% is a number which is given to as a number for herd immunity. So if you calculate our population of our size at 1,000 rupees, it's going to be several lakh crores of rupees which will be spent on vaccination, totally not feasible. So we have taken an approach which is a very difficult approach, because in our live attenuated vaccine technology, it will stimulate both humoral immunity and cell-mediated immune response, and probably one or two doses is sufficient for, we expect that one or two doses is sufficient for the entire lifespan, and the cost would be not as high as well. So, under normal circumstances, live attenuated vaccines would take several years to develop. If you see, there are very successful live attenuated vaccines like measles vaccine, which is rubella vaccine, which is being used now. But we have modern technology called codon deoptimization. With that, with the help of our collaborators in Australia and in the US, we are now, we have almost constructed 20 live attenuated codon deoptimized viruses. We will start the mice studies in September. And then we'll do the non-human primate studies in October. And we are planning to start the phase one trials as early as January 2021. So thing is, our approach takes a little longer because technologically it's much more challenging to do. But then when it comes as a vaccine, then we will be the most cost effective, and it'll be a vaccine which where you administer once or twice and then you don't have to administer for the rest of the life. So that's the approach that we're taking. And in the meantime, we do have spare capacity. If any of our friends want to utilize some of our fill-finish capacity, they are free to approach us, and we are always happy to share our capacity.
Did you say free to approach, or did you say free to use as well? Thank you, Anand, for that generous offer.
Could I just make a quick comment on the collaboration?
Please.
I was in discussions with Adar from the Serum Institute. We have an association called the Vaccine Manufacturing Association, in which Indian manufacturers are part of that. And in that context, we've been in discussion over several policy issues. And this certainly came up there's a principal understanding between us that we will deploy capacities for each other. And what's important to understand, it's not just in the context of COVID, but while we're trying to develop COVID vaccines, we have routine immunization commitments and supply commitments on Rota, on, you know, DPT, Penta. But it's not easy to deploy capacity with each other because of the way the regulatory system is set up. So if father wanted to say that, you know, B, you fill my pentavalent because, you know, I have COVID obligations, for us to do that, we have to potentially go through clinical trials, but it requires a lot of regulatory work and potentially 6 to 8 months before we even are able to do that. So if we can shift the needle there, it allows more flexibility for us to be open. But I think in principle, we all want to deploy infrastructure in a way that best serves humanity at a critical time like this.
I think you put it really, really pointedly. Krishna, would you like to also comment on this idea of collaboration?
I just want to say that I'm glad you organized this meeting. We may be competing, all three of us, but we're all of us competing with infectious disease. Please keep in mind that we may compete in the marketplace, but we are competing against infectious disease. That is common goal for all of us. You know, I mean, yes, Indian manufacturers need the time now to collaborate more. It's easy to collaborate with the US and other people, but with India, it's a little difficult because we have cultural problem. We don't trust our own brothers, that's unfortunately. So the culture has to change, but definitely that is required. But I want to say one more important point in front of Honorable Minister. India is manufacturing 100 doses. Serum Institute is only making 30. 70% of the other vaccine comes three manufacturers. Keep that in mind. That means 70% of India comes from three manufacturers. That means Hyderabad is nothing less than Serum Institute. Please keep in mind. As a single company may be different, but all three manufacturers, we are more than double than the Serum Institute as a combined strength of Hyderabad. And I want to tell you that partnership is now, the disease is getting complex. I think we need a partnership. We don't even, we are buying from tetanus from BE now. We said we have to stop importing things rather than we collaborate among ourselves. And I think it will start right now. I think the minister has organized this meeting. It brings some comfort level to all of us also in a way. But I can tell you one more thing. Telangana will lead innovation in India. Please keep this line tagged. Okay? Telangana will lead the innovation of India. There's nothing less. Because it's not that because ministry is here, I'm telling you this. I'm seeing the ecosystem that we are building in. You see this sort of ecosystem of manufacturing, R&D, very high intense. Bangalore gets unnecessarily a popularity of the media. But actually, we have better better ecosystem than any other state of the country. But I think we need to see, and actually, we've done typhoid conjugate, first vaccine in the world. So that comes from Hyderabad. So a lot of vaccines. Now even BE is developing new vaccine. They are developing new vaccine. Everything is going to come from here. So there's nothing less than that. And I think we are nowhere less than any other companies in the world. Thank you,
Krishna. In fact, since this morning, I've been hearing a number of things on the innovation front and how important innovation is in your line of work. We have T-Hub in our state. We have T-Works. You know, we have a bunch of other initiatives that start with T. But I've also realized this morning after talking out to all of you that T-cells are equally important. You know, I think in this process, I think we have one more sort of an addition to this T portfolio. But before I go into other questions or other points, I think a question to all three of you. I think each of you should respond to this. See, India now and Indians now are looking forward to you guys with a lot of anticipation. We want the vaccine to be cheap and affordable. We want it to come yesterday, if not, you know, say a month from now. You know, that quickly we want it. We also want accessibility, and like Dr. Swaminathan pointed out, we don't want hoarding happening. We don't want only the privileged and the rich in India to be getting the first shots and, you know, them to be safer than the others. So we cannot have that divide as well. But that is the ask, that is the demand. Now the question to you guys is, what can governments do? Because I just heard Mahima say, sometimes when I want to really change gears and move fast, the regulatory framework comes in the way. Be it in the state, be it the DCGI, be it Delhi. What do we need? What do we need to do as governments to enable you? Because Like I said, you know, we are a developing country. We are a third world country. We can't invest lots and lots of money in research and development from the exchequer's or the consolidated money or the exchequer's money. But how do we facilitate? How do we encourage you? How do we take away the hurdles? How do we ensure these roadblocks in your regulatory approval processes are removed? The reason why I ask is because I want to appeal to Government of India, from the industry here, from the government here, taking into account all of your viewpoints and taking into account all of your ideas and suggestions. I want to write to them, I want to request them, I want to reach out to them and be your advocate for the industry in terms of ensuring that we compete with the world on an even keel. If the world is actually moving at a brisk pace, it is primarily because they don't have as many legal hurdles, as many regulatory hurdles as we have in India. So please do vent, please do talk, please do tell us what we need to change from within, in state government here, and also in Delhi. What are the things that you would like to see differently, starting with maybe Krishna, and then we go to Mahima, and then to Anand?
I think this is a very important point. The vaccine field, unfortunately, controlled 90% by the federal government. That is number one. What we need as a Telangana, if you want to become a global player, we need CDSO, which is Drug Control Office, to have decentralized the power to Hyderabad. We need a South India headquarters of CDSO in the South India so that it can be Hyderabad, and that will strengthen, because we don't have, for a small clearance also, we're rushing to Delhi. It doesn't make sense for us. And the country is a big country, and 60% of the pharma is coming from here. So naturally, we need to have CDSO headquarters decentralize some of the power, 90% of the power, to be decentralized and located in Hyderabad. That will change the game for us, for Telangana. Number two, RCGM, DVT. Again, that has to be decentralized. Put a one small institute here, right in Genome Valley. They can be located here with the two offices. They clear everything except the one BSL-3 area, highly contained organism can go there. Remaining all can be done. Because this is the only country, even for small R&D, sir, we need a permission from DBT. I don't know, they are the facilitator of the country's industry, but they're also in the regulatory chair. That is hurting us, actually, very bad. For every small R&D material to import, we need a permission of RCGM. That is going to kill a lot of startup companies in this country. It's hurting us, actually, very bad. And I think RCGM, at least if they can't close down, at least they should be decentralized and put them here. Third important is, every batch that we send to CRI Kasoli, if they can set up in Hyderabad one more testing where state government can build that infrastructure and give it to them, they can have a testing facility here. If they do that, and I think we'll rule the country.
Thank you, Krishna. In fact, on the last point, the testing center has been approved for Hyderabad. It will be up and running hopefully soon. But we'll hear from Mahima as well what she thinks needs to be done by governments in terms of removing these legal hurdles and regulatory hurdles.
So first, sir, I would break it down into the more immediate things that can be done and some of the more institutional challenges, which will take time to accomplish. But once we accomplish those, they will pave the way for more innovation, not just in the context of COVID. So first, in the context of COVID, I would really like to highlight funding. So most manufacturers sitting at this table don't have access. We're doing this at risk. We're doing this, you know, with commercial sources of capital. It's very challenging to do efficacy studies, global efficacy and safety studies, and invest in infrastructure when there's no pull mechanism that's visible. Now, the COVAX facility is one way where they're kind of trying to give you demand certainty, but that hasn't been forthcoming from our own government, which is a bit disappointing, because we need to understand what the allocation strategy of the country will look like. Given all vaccines will not be available from day one, what is the volume you need for first responders? What is the volume you need in the second tranche? What is the overall immunization strategy? Is it 60% of the people? Is it 100% of the people? And I often use these terms, pull and push mechanisms. There are no pull mechanisms. In the absence of the pull mechanism, it makes the lack of push mechanisms even more extreme. Our funding is extremely fragmented through BIRAC. Many countries, including China and the US, have fully funded at-risk several programs, making sure that they have access to vaccines first, that they have access to a diverse portfolio of vaccines, and supporting companies to set up huge infrastructure. Now, this has long-term implications because India is the number one vaccine player in the world. In not many industries can we claim to have that advantage, and I worry that by empowering everyone else in this fashion and not empowering India, we are losing in the long term a certain competitive advantage to other countries. This is easily done. The World Bank has $2 billion in funding that they're making available specifically to vaccine manufacturers to expand their infrastructure. But India needs to agree on terms to access those funds and make them available to a handful of manufacturers who they have, who have the track record to making this happen. So I've gone out on a limb here, but I think funding is a key thing. The second are the regulatory challenges. And it's not in the day-to-day clearances, because I have to say that between DBT and the DCGI, they have been proactive in reaching out and saying, if you don't get clearance in 24 hours, so has the state of Telangana. You know, I get called, the reverse is happening, so it's actually kind of interesting to be put on the other side of things. So it's not about the day-to-day. But India still hasn't made clear the guidelines for what it means to license a vaccine. What efficacy parameters are you going to use? And FDA and WHO have published those guidelines. I know India is still working on the guidelines, but they haven't been published. This is really important, because then you measure every vaccine with the same yardstick, and then you ensure safety. So I think we immediately need those guidelines to be put in place, because manufacturers have a goal. Is it immunogenicity? Is it fourfold increase? Or do you expect efficacy, like WHO does expect efficacy? And what is that need is not being made clear. And the third challenge, I would say, is really this issue of allocation, which I touched upon. And that issue of allocation is not just a pull mechanism, but it's extremely important in the context of India contributing to the global equity, to global equitable access. And I just want to sign off by saying that from our standpoint, our philosophy has been that we ensure equitable access. For us, all children are created equal, and we want to make sure that the price of the vaccine doesn't come in the way of a country making a decision to adopt the vaccine. We will do everything possible to make sure the country is incentivized to adopt the vaccine. Now, when it comes to institutional challenges, they're more fundamental. We don't have enough clinical trial sites and infrastructure in the country to rapidly deploy 15 different vaccines into different clinical trial cohorts. We don't have access to discovery-related infrastructure. Like right now, to do the non-human primate challenge studies, all of us are standing in line, and that's very hard to access. And the third one is the regulatory framework. I heard someone refer to this in an article, calling it the bureaucratic cholesterol. So we need some kind of anticoagulants to unblock that bureaucratic cholesterol in the long term to be very effective.
I've heard many things, but I've never heard bureaucratic cholesterol. That's interesting. I'm going to use this term a bit more now. Thank you. No, not at all. In fact, I think it's some plain speak is sometimes much, much required than what we would like to believe. Thank you. Thank you very much for that perspective. And another take home for me is, you said all children are created equal. I think all humans, all children, all of us are created equal. It's just that the access and the affordability piece, I think that is what has been a huge challenge. Now, let's go to Anand. Anand, a lot of times people assume that since you're named Indian Immunological, you're actually owned by the government. But but I think you should give us a perspective of how your experience has been in dealing with the regulatory framework, the regulatory roadblocks, etc. Tell us what needs to change. Tell us how a state can be your partner in terms of ensuring that your voice is heard in Delhi and action is taken, especially in these testing times.
Thanks a lot. And first, let me start by saying that there has not been one meeting in the country. There are only 7 serious vaccine manufacturers in the country. There's not been one meeting held where all these 7 people have been brought together into one room and try to even understand where we are related to in terms of R&D. And see, the country has a lot of infrastructure built in terms of science, but they're all in silos. You have a lot of academic research institutes across the country. But then you have vaccine manufacturers. There's not been any attempt to bring them all together. In the sense that if this was done, then probably we could, as Mahima said, today, even for small testing, we have to send outside the country for testing. But we have within India, we have a lot of the research institutes which belong to DBT and CSR, which could come and help us in terms of providing various, in terms of developing any test methods or helping us with some process development issues. So that kind of bringing together all the vaccine manufacturers along with some leading academic institutes would to an extent help us a lot. Next is Mahima touched upon funding. As you said, we don't see any pull mechanism because each of us, as of now, we are just trying to spend from our own pockets, not even knowing like how much of this is going to be taken up later. And so there has to be some kind of a mechanism which would at least help us de-risk in this funding mechanism. The third is the regulatory, which Dr. Ella talked about. True that today, under normal circumstances itself, reaching out to the regulatory authorities is very difficult. And now, especially in COVID times, it's not easy, feasible for us to travel to Delhi as frequently as we did. So if some kind of a decentralization of that can happen, especially if some of those authorities can be given to Hyderabad, then that would definitely help us in our development process and also regulatory approval process.
Fantastic. In fact, I heard three words very clearly: decentralize, funding, and be flexible. These are the three messages, I think, for the government from the industry. I think these three things, if we can take care of, I think more and more can happen. I don't know if we still have Dr. Swaminathan with us. Is she on, Shakti? Is she still with us? Dr. Swaminathan, I'm not sure if you're with us. If you are, ma'am, I'd like to ask you one quick question. Or before she joins us, in fact, we can possibly have, you know, another question taken as well. Mahima, one of the things, again, that was discussed during the course of the discussion today is about capacities. Now, like you mentioned 80 to 100 million doses per month that potentially can be manufactured as and when you get the approval after phase three. We are a country of 1.3 billion people. I think the entire country is looking at vaccine manufacturers with a great deal of anticipation. How do you see the timelines in terms of rollout, in terms of how our capacities can be expanded, et cetera, and how quickly can we ramp up to cover, firstly, obviously, the most vulnerable, and then maybe cover all sets of people across the country? How do you see that panning out?
So this really would vary from technology to technology, sir, because some technologies have inherent limitations. So cell culture-based technologies are harder to scale. So for instance, if you're in cell cubes or cell factories, then you need to adopt to fermentation to be able to scale much more rapidly and quicker. So there's one on the drug substance side, what we call the upstream side. And I think on the upstream side, the only way to scale in a time-bound fashion is to collaborate and to look to contract manufacturing capacity and so on and so forth. Because to set up a drug substance facility from scratch is going to take a minimum of 18 months. And I'm being extremely optimistic by saying it's 18 months. So that's not going to happen. So the only way is to look at, you know, who has microbial fermentation facilities? Who has cell culture facilities? How quickly can I collaborate? And if you see the AstraZeneca model, that's exactly what they've done. They have a manufacturing site in US, in Europe, and in India. So when we think about it, we need to think, you know, more locally as well as globally to look at how we expand drug substance. In our case, we would be able to deploy other infrastructure or other programs, assuming that it doesn't cause a disruption to routine immunization. We could deploy other infrastructure to do campaigning. But one thing that remains common as an infrastructure that everybody needs is going to be fill-finish capacity. Today, one of the big concerns is, will there be enough glass tubing? Will there be enough vials in which you put the vaccine? You know, we really haven't had this scale of expansion or need for vials ever before. So for even the back-end support manufacturers to be able to supply materials, is still going to be a challenge, something that we'll have to see, so such that they are not allocating to the highest bidder, so to speak, right? But the one infrastructure that's common to all of us is fill finish infrastructure, because majority of these vaccines, barring a few which are nasal sprays or attempting to be nasal sprays, they're all injectables. And creating that additional fill finish infrastructure right now will enable us to deliver those 8 billion doses in the most rapid fashion possible, because that will be rate limiting at one point, where the drug substance can be scaled, but you won't be able to fill it in vials. So from a manufacturing perspective, we're trying to do everything we can by looking at 20 dose presentation, 30 dose, having preservatives that, you know, will take us through a much larger vial. But what I've been, you know, trying to advocate for, particularly with DBT and such, including CEPI, is to say create a fund where people can access money to expand their fill finish infrastructure. And why is this a good thing? There's no downside risk. Even if your vaccine candidate doesn't work, you can ensure that that infrastructure is deployed for whichever vaccine candidate that works. So, you know, it's not a win or lose situation for the government to make a bet on. But these are very critical to be able to rapidly scale. And the third thing, and very important factor, is availability of trained manpower. Right now, we envision creating an additional 500 jobs within the next 6 months. But we really need skilled workforce, and that's a long-term thing as well. But these three things will enable us to rapidly scale.
Thank you, Mahima. In fact, I think it's not a zero-sum game, is what Mahima says from the government perspective. Krishna, before you know, we get to Dr. Swaminathan, who will possibly join us a bit. She's gone? Okay. Before we go to her, or I think it looks like she's left us, but equitable distribution. I know you are on the verge of phase three, possibly end of this month. So since we are looking at you with a great deal of optimism, how do we ensure as a country, 1.3 billion people, we know your abilities to manufacture, we know that there is always a limitation, certain cap on how much you can manufacture. How do we ensure that this equitable distribution just doesn't remain in the paper, and like Mahima said, the highest bidder? Because I've heard you in other webinars where you said, you know, Chinese government came in and blocked the entire South American market on some other vaccine development process. How do we ensure that such a thing does not happen, and how do we ensure Hyderabad, you know, being the vaccine capital of the world, how do we ensure we assert our position? How do we ensure we not only supply for India, we also manufacture and supply to the rest of the world in a very equitable fashion? How do we do that?
I just want to blame the government for that matter, honestly. The reason is the government is looking at it more on a health point of view, COVID problem. But I consider it's economic point of view. If somebody is starving with the loss of a job and loss starving, he's going to die. That's much worse. And the WHO and the Indian government, the drug controller, looks at what is 1% adverse reactions and all that. But they're not looking at it, how do we deploy faster? It is possible. Technology now, new technologies, and all the manufacturers, we have all the quality control systems in place. There's nothing that we're short-circuit anything. But I think government has to sit in the central government and call the manufacturers, tell me what you want. Each one is, they're working in compartment. They say, we are fast-track. But all put together, no fast track in the country. So literally, it is an isolation. Each one want to look at microscope. How come this Indian company can develop this COVID vaccine? Let me look at it. If it comes from US, no scrutiny much. But I think that system has to be put now. Our chief minister has to put a pressure on the prime minister's office. Something the drug controller and DBT, all of them, principal secretary should stick together, call the manufacturers, quick strategy discussion, and how do we execute? There must be one leader there should be executed. If it is done, honestly, I'm telling you, all the four manufacturers, three from here, Serum, can feed the entire 1.2 billion. Coming to affordability, trust me, I'm telling you, we are lesser than water bottle cost of vaccines. So water bottle is more expensive.
I'm sure the vaccine wouldn't be as much, 330 ml.
So this is five times more expensive than your vaccine. So we are really affordable. I think we are the lowest in the world. and the best quality. Trust me, I'm telling you. Our quality of a vaccine, Indian manufacturer's quality of vaccine, and GSK and Sanofi is exactly same. Please keep in mind, we follow exactly WHO, TRS, and USFDA guidelines. Nothing less. You know, people think Indian vaccine means something low quality. No, all are same quality. There's only one quality in vaccine field. There's no two quality. So only one quality, be assured of that. And I think, you know, there's some strategic discussion missing. Leadership is missing in Delhi to take on, quickly sit together and put a strategy. Chinese, what they've done, they've given $1 billion to Mexico, blocking the entire Latin American market. They went to Egypt, they're blocking the African market. I really think in 5 years, the Gavi may not exist, UNICEF also may not exist. The way Chinese going and dominating the country's market. It's very scary.
Krishna, in fact, I agree with you on two things here. First thing, I think, is Government of India really needs to take all stakeholders, including the states and the manufacturers, into confidence, strategize together. Instead of saying just 1 billion doses for a period of so many days or months or so many weeks, we need to strategize on not only on vaccine distribution, but also when we go into that phase where we have to test larger population. I think we need strategies, we need to test all corners of the country, and we need to ensure that the vaccine is made available. Secondly, on Krishna's point, I can vouch for it, because I have been to his lab today on the, you know, biosafety level 3, BSL 3, a standard lab. Not just the lab, in fact, the manufacturing facility. I'm told it's one of its kind in the world, not just in India, but it's one of its kind in the world. I am delighted and thrilled, you know, to have witnessed something of that caliber and that standard in Hyderabad. I'm sure other labs are also, you know, labs are of BSL 3 level, but manufacturing at BSL 3 level is also something that is truly unique. So we can certainly compete in terms of quality, in terms of cost, in terms of scale with everybody else in the world. So I also agree with you on the fact that we need to possibly position ourselves, brand ourselves, and talk up in the sense of Government of India and the state governments promoting you and, you know, encouraging the local manufacturers. Now, Anand, on this issue of equitable distribution, I've heard Prime Minister Modi talk about how we could possibly start planning now to distribute this vaccine to the large, you know, population of our country. What are your thoughts? And then we go to final comments from each of us, each of you.
As you rightly said, like, we need to ponder on this. Like, it's not just developing a vaccine. And then how do we address this 1 billion population who have to be immunized? Because it, from a child to a senior citizen has to be given this vaccine. So in terms of, see, each company, currently what we do is, like, we have certain manufacturing capacity for existing vaccines. Like, say, we produce various kinds of vaccines for the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. And then what now we are doing is some of those spare capacities is what we are going to use for when this COVID vaccine candidate comes. So we are going to use some of the spare capacities that we have. So the amount of spare capacity that exists in each of the vaccine manufacturers, that is not determined yet. I mean, even if any vaccine, like say if Dr. Ella was to develop the Covaxin, and if there's additional capacity required, so far no attempts have been made to even understand how much spare capacities are available with other manufacturers. Now that I heard from Mahima that they're going to produce like 80 million doses a month, and they are worried about their inability to fill finish. I'm happy to offer, we have put a brand new fill finish facility just 7-8 kilometers from here, which can fill 200 million doses, if it is a 10 dose vial, and if it is a 20 dose vial, it will be much more than that.
You guys so need to you guys need to meet more often, I think.
So some kind of a dialogue among vaccine manufacturers should happen, because it's not about a race as to who comes out with the vaccine first, who makes the most money, or it's not about that. It's like, how do we address, I mean, if you see in terms of the size, today you see the polio vaccine program is supposed to be the biggest, but that's catering to only 27 million. But today you're talking about a billion people, and what mechanism is there in case if a candidate comes, how are you going to mass produce? And then how are you also going to distribute? If it's going to be a vaccine which has to be stored at minus 70 or beyond, then really we lack the infrastructure for those kind of things. So I think some high-level planning at the center has to happen to ensure speedy development, also adequate distribution across the country.
Well, I can't speak for center, but I assure you of this. We will plan for our state, we'll plan for, because you know, you guys are manufacturing right here. I think it's only a matter of local pride and also a matter of social responsibility that we also take care of the state that we're working in. So I certainly promise you this, that we will strategize for our state, our health department, and our Honorable Chief Minister, of course, has been talking about it, but I think a well-laid plan needs to be in place in terms of ensuring the infrastructure to even store, like you pointed out, Anand, the vaccines, and also distribution. How do we do it? Pan entire 4 crore people, that needs to be planned. Now, since this is the first time all three of you are coming together onto a platform, we did a little bit of a survey. I tweeted, I said, you know, what are the questions that you would like answers to, etc. The one question that came on tops, which I think you all can guess, that will be the last question for all three of you. See, it's like looking at a crystal maze and answering this one. Maybe you have more solid basis and solid grounding to answer this than any of us in this room right here. We'll start with Mahima. The question that is on everybody's mind: when is the vaccine likely to come out, right? And how long is it going to be effective for? I think it's a tough question, I know, but I think I would want your educated, because since you're in this, since you've been in this business for decades, I want a very simple, to-the-point answer on when do you think it'll happen and how do you think it's going to pan out from there on?
Between Q1 next year and Q3 next year, you should start to see at least 5 candidates get licensed.
Q1 and Q3,
yeah.
That is January,
anywhere between the third quarter.
Anywhere
in the world.
Anywhere in the world, of course.
Yeah. So I think that. How long really the epidemiology of the virus is not known. So will it be a seasonal, like a flu shot that you have to take every year because it's mutated enough that it warrants redevelopment? Or is there enough persistence to last a year? Now, one of the trade-offs is everybody wants a single-dose vaccine because it's easy to administer. Now, all single-dose vaccines may not be as persistent. So it's really a trade-off between number of doses, persistence, and all of that. Time will tell. I'm afraid I couldn't predict anything on persistence at this
point. Q1 to Q3, and you're saying it could either be in the form of a annual shot like for flu, or it could be a, depending on
the
epidemiology, could be a 5 years.
Depends. Typically, we would have done this all before licensure, but given the risk, we're going ahead in licensing. So we'll only know post-licensure of a vaccine how long the duration of protection lasts.
All right. Thank you. And let's go to Anand. Anand, Mahima says Q1 to Q3 next year. And Mahima also says it could be, depending on the epidemiology of the virus, it could vary.
As I said, we have taken the most technology-challenging route to this particular vaccine candidate development. I mean, bearing in mind that when it comes as a successful candidate, that it offers tremendous advantages over other vaccines because, one, the cost will be low. Next is it would provide lifelong immunity, which we hope that would do with a single dose. And we are hoping that somewhere between, because it's a live attenuated, codon de-optimized vaccine, we are hoping that somewhere between Q2 to Q3, we should have something in our hand.
Q2 to Q3. And you're saying that your vaccine will have a potentially longer impact and it will be more affordable.
Yeah, because it stimulates, there's a lot of published literature how a live attenuated vaccine works, because it stimulates both humoral and cell-mediated immunity and also a very good memory as well. So we are hoping that one or at the most 2 shots will protect for lifetime.
Thank you, Anand. Krishna, we'll let you have the final word. I know you're working on 3 different vaccines in 3 different parts of the world. Tell us what you believe is going to come out first. Also tell us how you see this remaining effective and the efficacy of the vaccine per se. How do you see that also helping?
Are getting into the vaccine field. This is very surprising things we're seeing, the transition. And now they are bringing their adjuvant, their strategy of immunity is bringing into the vaccine field now, first time. So what we have is right now is the Th2 response. And now people are realizing T TH2 is no use. We need TH1, cell-mediated response. That's a good sign, already figured out that. So when you have that figured out, now adjuvant will come in, live vaccines, other things will come in, and that will take place right now. And people will figure out whether maybe live combined with inactivated, inactivated with live, all these combinations will come out. By next year, they'll figure out the science. And I'm not very optimistic, because the intensity of the research, first time I'm seeing so many companies getting in, and the immunology will build up. See, something earlier, immunology was working separately, vaccine field was working separately. This is the first time I'm seeing integration of the both right now. And I'm very optimistic that you're going to see, and people are going to follow whatever, whoever, suppose we vaccinate the phase one trial, we're going to monitor them next 2-3 years. And we have done typhoid conjugate, we monitored 5 years, it's gone down, then immediately shot with another booster, again shot it up. So we follow them, those people. It's not that the clinical trial is over, we left off the patients. We're going to monitor them continuously. And when it goes down, we're going to understand again science. So clinical research is going to be an important field right now in this, more than the biological R&D angle. More than R&D, it's going to be clinical research, which is going to tell us a lot of things.
Understand. But the dates that you're looking at, the timelines that you're looking at?
I think the media is there. I don't want to comment. I'm very scared of that.
Well, we've said enough for them to cover. But listen, the good news is this. The good news, I believe, is that there will be a vaccine. Now, that's what the industry seems to think. That's what they're confident about. Now, the not-so-good news is that we may have to wait. We may have to wait for another 6 months or 9 months or 12 months, depending on whose perspective and what prism you're looking through. So, therefore, we have to ensure, as Dr. Soumya Swaminathan pointed out so eloquently, she said the new normal, the new way of life that we all have to get used to, the physical distancing, the masking, the ensuring that we sanitize, ensuring that we don't pass the infection, ensure that the government's test, and also continue to isolate, continue to flatten the curve as we've been talking about for a while. All of these things are points that you will keep hearing over and over the next few months. Once again, I compliment the entire life sciences ecosystem in the state of Telangana and particularly in Genome Valley here. You guys are, like I said earlier today at Bharat Biotech, you guys are no less than the frontline warriors, because you've been exposing yourself to these viruses, these microbes, which potentially have a huge detrimental effect on your health. But you've been fighting this battle, and you give us that ray of hope. You give us that absolute faith that positive things are around the corner. So my compliments to the entire life sciences ecosystem in Genome Valley. Once again, I'd like to thank Dr. Soumya Swaminathan, who joined us from Geneva, the Chief Scientist of World Health Organization, and Mahima Datlo of Biologically for joining us. Ma'am, thank you. I was just about thanking you, but I have one last question before we sign off. One last question. Ma'am, you've done extensive work in tuberculosis. Your research is considered pioneering and benchmarking. I'm sure your expertise and your experience with tuberculosis definitely also, gives you a lot of positive inputs going down further in view of COVID as well. One question I do have. As World Health Organization's chief scientist, how can you ensure that there is no hoarding? How can we ensure that vaccine, whenever it comes up, how do we ensure that it doesn't go to the highest bidder, like you pointed out during SARS and H1N1? Some countries have hoarded only when they've realized that the epidemic is not as strong as they thought it would be. Only then they decided to, be generous and share it with other developing nations. How can we ensure that the most deserving, most needy, irrespective of their geographic location, get the vaccine ahead of anybody else, and then it goes on in that order of priority? How can WHO play a pivotal role in working with various governments across the world? And how can we in India and how can we in Telangana also possibly play a role, active role, along with WHO, in ensuring that this process is expedited for the benefit of humanity?
Thank you for this very interesting session that I was following. The last question you asked me is actually a very good one, and one that I think everyone has to ask themselves.
ultimately it is the 194 countries of members of the World Health Organization that need to come together and take a decision on which way they want to proceed. Equitable and fair distribution of vaccines and other health products that are being developed for COVID. One of the things that we launched in May is something called the CTAP, that is the COVID Technology Access Pool. This is to encourage governments as well as companies to pool their technologies and intellectual properties, anything related to COVID. It also includes data, research, knowledge, but could also include patents on vaccines and on drugs. And we hope that this technology access pool will be a mechanism for people to be able to share their discoveries and share their knowledge freely so that more people can be benefited. And we have seen this happen actually in a large number of cases. People have actually created something and said, this is for use and benefit of the public at large. When it comes to drugs and vaccines, which are developed by mostly by private companies, things become a little more complex. And the usual practice is for those companies to retain the IP. So we have to see here whether we can change that paradigm. And even if IP is retained, there should be technology sharing. Because in the case of vaccines, it's really a question of the know-how. And finally, it's the political leaders who will make the decisions, because every country is governed by their own laws and, you know, their own leaders, their parliament or governance structures. And they can take decisions which are a sovereign right. So the hope really here is that they put the global needs above their own national needs, since the virus does not respect borders. And we know that the economic fallout globally is so huge, it's like running into trillions of dollars every month, that the amount of investment to both develop and distribute a vaccine is going to be in billions. We're asking for about $30 billion for the COVAX pillar in order to develop and distribute vaccines to the whole world. So it's only a fraction of the actual economic losses which are occurring because of COVID. And even if one country is able to protect their entire population, it's not going to help, because the infection is going to keep moving and traveling between countries, as we have seen. So it is in everybody's self-interest to ensure that there is sort of a global access to whatever tools are being developed. So let us hope that the global solidarity takes precedence over vaccine nationalism. And so what we would like to see is solidarity and vaccine multilateralism, where wherever, regardless of where a vaccine is developed, whichever country, it's made available to the world based on some of the criteria that we had talked about earlier. And I'm sure that India would be a leader in that, that philosophy and that goal. The Prime Minister has often spoken about innovating for not only Indians, but for the world. And so we should actually be in the forefront of advocating for this and also for following this principle and helping other leaders also take the right decision. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam. Thank you so much for joining us, and thanks for taking the time out and actually giving us sharing a lot of thoughts with us. Once again, I promise all three of you, the industry leaders here, that we will continue to champion this angle of decentralized fund and also be flexible in terms of our regulatory framework with Government of India. We will be your advocate from state government in ensuring that your voice is heard and the life sciences ecosystem in Hyderabad and Telangana is further strengthened. So thank you very much, Dr. Swaminathan. Thank you, Mahima. Thank you, Anand. And thank you, Krishna, once again for joining us. Look forward to strengthening and augmenting our ecosystem here. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Cheers.
Bye-bye.
And is it afternoon, morning? What is it?
How are you?
Very, very good, ma'am. Very good. You know, we have Mahima Datla, we have Dr. Krishna Ella, and we have Anand Kumar, all of us. And of course, you've been here in Genome Valley in 2017, February, about 3 years ago, 3.5 years ago.
Yes.
I'm told you're in Geneva, that, ma'am.
I remember that visit very well to the Genome Valley.
Oh, thank you.
And visiting several of the company who are there.
Fantastic. Ma'am, we'll get started. We'll get started whenever you're ready. So, can we get started?
Yes, I'm ready.
And you're going to be with us for what, 45 minutes, 1 hour? Depending on that, we'll structure the flow. Yeah?
45 minutes, I can still.
All right, thank you. Thank you so much. So, good afternoon to Dr. Soumya Swaminathan, who's the Chief Scientist of World Health Organization. She is somebody who's very familiar with the life sciences ecosystem of India, of course, and also the life sciences ecosystem of Telangana and Hyderabad, and more particularly Genome Valley, which is right here. She was, in fact, she obviously, like I pointed out just now, she had visited Genome Valley in 2017, about three plus years ago, and we also have had a couple of interactions with her when she was heading ICMR, and just a pleasure and delight to have you, ma'am, with us. Thank you very much for joining us, and thank you very much for your time. We have with us Mahima Datla of Biological E. We have Anand Kumar of Indian Immunologicals, and we also have Dr. Krishna Ella of Bharat Biotech. As we all know, this is an unprecedented time. These are uncharted waters for all of us, in fact, without an exception. So this is an exciting time also from the perspective of you know, just believing that every adversity has an inherent opportunity that lies within. And today, Hyderabad and our life sciences ecosystem here is truly fortified its position, has really shown its strength to the world, not only from our pharmaceutical sector, but also from our biotechnology and vaccine manufacturing facilities in Hyderabad. I'm proud to share with you that Hyderabad continues to remain, you know, one of the leaders in vaccine manufacturing. We, in fact, today manufacture more than one-third vaccines that are used globally. And we also have, in fact, like I pointed out, been home to pharma companies which have been producing the drugs such as Remdesivir, Flavipiravir, etc., which have all been in use in the last few months. Delighted that Hyderabad's ecosystem, more particularly the three companies which are right here with us, are leading the vaccine race. There are more than 150 vaccines that are currently under development at various stages across the world. But within India, we have six companies that are in the race. And out of those six, I'm proud to share with you, four of them actually are headquartered in Hyderabad. And three of them are sitting right here with us. So I'm here more to learn from them. I'm here more to understand from them, like every other layman out there in India and elsewhere, on what is happening in today's world and what is happening in the vaccine manufacturing and also other developments with respect to COVID and this pandemic. We'll get started, with Dr. Swaminathan. Did we lose her? Dr. Swaminathan? Swamyaji? We'll get started with you, ma'am. Ma'am, you'll have to unmute yourself. We'll get started with you.
Yes.
Yeah. Ma'am, just a quick, initial thoughts. A lot of data, a lot of research, a lot of articles these days, you know, with WhatsApp and, you know, social media being all pervasive, everybody seems to know everything. But let me get it from the chief scientist of World Health Organization. How long do you think we have to learn to live with this? Because I think that realization has dawned upon all of us that we have to coexist with the virus for a bit. But how long do you think we have to live with this? How long do you think we have to coexist? How do you see the future panning out over the next few months at least?
Yes. No. Thank you very much, Minister. First of all, congratulations on organizing this program today. I think it's very timely, the discussion on vaccines
really needs to happen at different levels, both globally and nationally. I'd like to tell you a little bit about what we are doing and how we are thinking about it, and also answer your question about how long will this last and what else should we be doing. Maybe I can start with that. We know now that this novel coronavirus has established itself in the world. It has gone into practically every country, and wherever it has found a situation where it's able to spread easily from person to person, it has established community transmission, and it just goes through the population because we do not have much of pre-existing immunity to this. Now, I will add a caveat there because we are still learning about the immunity to this virus. It is possible that previous exposure to some other coronaviruses might offer some protection. That is one of the questions which are still open and can only be answered if we study cohorts of people right through and establish cohorts and see who are the people who get more severe infection versus less severe infection. Why do children appear to be relatively less susceptible to disease? They do get the infection, but they don't get sick most of the time. And why is it that with increasing age and with some of the comorbidities, we see increasing severity and increasing mortality? And how long is the immunity going to last after natural infection? We know now that most people who have natural infection develop neutralizing antibodies, and they also seem to develop T cell immunity. So both the cellular and the humoral immune system is activated. But what we don't know is when do these antibodies start reducing, and for how long is there protective immunity? And this has implications for vaccines. If long-lasting immunity cannot be achieved after a natural infection, with the vaccine, again, we'll have to see. Because the vaccine is targeting, right now, all the vaccines are targeting the spike protein. The first generation vaccines are all targeting the spike protein because it's the most immunogenic protein of the virus. The only risk is if the virus develops a mutation which causes it to escape the immunity, which is conferred by the antibodies against the spike protein, then we are in a difficulty. So the second generation of vaccines actually targeting other antigens as well. So we need also backup plans. And the second thing which we can only do when we introduce the vaccine into phase 3 trials and follow people is to see how long is the immunity going to last, the protective immunity, whether it's a sterilizing immunity or it's only a disease-modifying immunity. Both types could happen with different vaccine candidates. So the message I would like to give right at the beginning is that for the foreseeable future, at least for the next 12 months, we need to put in place the public health and social measures that have been shown to work. And this is at the level of the government, the community, and the individual. Most countries who have controlled the virus successfully in the first phase have been because of good governance, good strategic planning based on scientific knowledge and based on evidence, and because of involvement of community and individual trust, good communication between the government and the people, clear communication, and being prepared to manage what is likely to happen in the future. We know that lockdowns are a temporary measure, which reduces the spread because you prevent people from getting close together. And the idea of the lockdown was to buy time for the government to put in place the systems needed to tackle the virus. And I strongly believe, and the WHO has been repeatedly emphasizing the fact, that testing is extremely important. Unless we test adequately, we don't know where the virus is. And Dr. Tedros once used the phrase, fighting a fire blindfolded. If you do not test, it's like fighting a fire blindfolded. We have to test and test and test. But testing alone is not going to solve the problem. It's the first step. That, of course, has to be followed by isolation of positive people, contact tracing, quarantining, taking care of those who are positive, following them to make sure that they don't get into the interstitial pneumonia and complications by monitoring their oxygen saturation. So it's a comprehensive package which needs to be put in place, particularly in those places where there is a high density of population, so the cities, for example. In the rural areas, it will be good to have some kind of a surveillance going on so that you know what is going on. This surveillance is usually done in the form of influenza-like illness surveillance or severe acute respiratory illness surveillance, what we call as ILI and SARI surveillance. If everybody who comes in with symptoms suggestive of influenza or of pneumonia is also tested for COVID-19, apart from other infections, like you can do a combined influenza COVID test, then you have a sort of a constant surveillance going on in the rural areas to know which districts, which villages are seeing infections going up. But in the cities, the only way out is to expand testing. India as a whole, the testing rates are much lower compared to some of the countries who have done well, like Germany, Taiwan, South Korea, Japan, even the United States is testing a huge number of people every day. So we need to have some benchmarks. In every public health department needs to have benchmarks on what is the rate of testing per lakh or per million. What is the test positivity rate? The moment your test positivity rate is above 5%, you know that we are not testing adequately. And then also looking constantly and monitoring the availability of beds, the availability of quarantine facilities, the availability of ICUs, oxygen availability in the district hospitals, and so on. So there is a set of about 8 to 10 indicators that the government needs to keep a close watch on. And you can ramp up and ramp down based on what you're seeing on the ground. And the other thing is about the communication to people and what people have to do. It's very nice to see everyone wearing a mask. And I must say I've been impressed in Chennai also, where the mask compliance seems to be very, very high. I'm not sure what it is in the rural areas or in the districts. We need to keep on because we need to learn. If the mask is hanging down below the nose or mouth, it's not going to be effective. But modeling has shown that if everyone wears a mask, you can really cut down on transmission. So it's really a very affordable, cost-effective, and effective measure for people. The other thing is, of course, maintaining distance as far as possible. In some situations, it's less possible because of slum areas and things like that. And also, we know where the clusters can happen. These happen in closed environments where people spend time together. So that is why you have to limit the number of people. But you have industries, factories, other kinds of places, even offices, where people just have to go because you have to restart your economy. That is where then you need to, again, to have a surveillance mechanism, temperature monitoring, making sure everybody's masked, making sure that people maintain the distance, that they have the respiratory etiquette, etc. So it's a very painstaking process, all of these steps, if they have to be implemented properly. But they do bear fruit and they do give results if done. Now over to vaccines, because that's what everybody is looking at as an exit strategy from the pandemic. Let's hope that several of the vaccine candidates in testing, today there are 27, I think, or 28 vaccines that are in clinical trials and another 150 odd which are in preclinical testing. At least 5 are now entering phase 3 trials. So we will know in the next few months about the safety and efficacy of these vaccines. And I emphasize safety as very important, because to get public trust when you are going to vaccinate huge numbers of healthy individuals, the safety bar of the vaccine has to be set quite high in order for it to be acceptable and usable in the population. So things like the disease enhancement, which is something which has happened